statement again?
Sure. This meeting is in compliance with the Open Public Meetings Act, as adequate notice of this meeting has been provided to the Westfield Leader and the Star Ledger, with the agenda specifying the time, place, and matters to be heard, having been posted in a bulletin board in the town hall reserved for such announcements, and the filing of said agenda with the Township Clerk of Cranford. Formal action may be taken at this meeting.
Thank you. I just ask everybody to stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. Do we need to call the roll again?
Yes.
Then go ahead.
Okay. Ms. Vidwans?
Here.
Mr. Reese?
Here.
Mr. Lucas?
Present.
Mr. Sikorski?
Present.
Mr. Aschenbach?
Here.
Mr. Murata?
Present.
Ms. Daly?
Present.
Mr. Jardine?
Present.
Mr. Boyer, our board engineer?
Present.
And Ms. Patras, our board planner?
Present. Thank you. We have two applications tonight. In a moment, Mr. Lucas will read the first application, but I just want to let everyone know how this will work. So we will do the first application first. This applicant is requesting an interpretation of a zoning ordinance. So it's not a typical application, but the applicant will present any witnesses that they want, and during that, any witness that is does give testimony, I will first let the board and the board's professionals ask any questions, and then I will open up to the members of the public if you want to ask questions. Just remember, at that time, you're only asking questions. It's not a time to make statements or comments. It's just a time to ask questions. Once the applicant has completed their presentation to the board, that's when I'll open it up to public comment. So if you have a comment or statement you want to make, that's the time that you'll make it. If you're making a statement or a comment, we'll ask you to state your name and your address and be sworn in. If you're asking questions, we'll just ask you to state your name and address. Once the public comment is finished, we'll let the applicant make a summary statement if they want to, and then we'll move to a board deliberation. When the board is deliberating, it's just for those people up here to have conversation about the application. There's no longer more back and forth between the applicants or any other person not on the board. Once the board votes on the first application, we'll move on to the second application. Mr. Lucas will read the application, and once again, the applicant will come forward. That's a more typical application. There will be witnesses, and we'll follow the same format that I just outlined. Once both applications have been reviewed, or it gets to 10:30, so after 10:30, we're not going to take any more new testimony. But after we're finished with the evening's work, then we will open. I will open it up for comment about. Public comment, but for things not in front of the zoning board and not coming in front of the zoning board. So that's how it will work. So why don't we go ahead and proceed. Mr. Lucas, can you read the first application, please?
This is application ZBA 23-018. Applicant Mark and Denise Smith, owner, Township of Cranford. 100 Lambert Street, Block 322, Lot 18, R1 Zone. The applicant is requesting an interpretation of the zoning ordinance pertaining to subsection 255-39, conditional uses.
Mr. Simon.
Madam Chair, members of the board, very, very good to be back here before all of you. Let me start with some preliminaries. Rob Simon from Herald Law. I'm here on behalf of Mark and Denise Smith, 35 Wade Avenue, Cranford. As the chairwoman stated, this application was submitted with regard to a request for an interpretation under 40:55D-70B. So before I even get started, Mr. Jardim knows, and I've spoken to Kathy as well, that unfortunately, due to some typo in the notice, that our notice is deficient. And as a result of that, for jurisdictional purposes, I unfortunately need to ask that the matter be carried to a future date so that we can re-notice, because we certainly need proper notice for purposes of of jurisdiction. I did speak to Tom, though, and he raised an issue with me, and it's really up to the board, based on counsel from Mr. Jardine. He raised an issue with me as to a separate jurisdictional issue with regard to the board hearing the application is submitted. So I figured, let me come down here, first of all, say hello, formally announce that we're going to have to carry it and establish a new date. But while I'm here, if it's up to the board whether they want to discuss a kind of a pre-application jurisdictional issue. How was that, Tom?
I think that's about right. I think the issue for the board is really in the nature almost of legal argument here tonight. We're going to hear from Mr. Simon as to why he believes that this application is properly in front of the board. The application involves municipal property. And so this board has to determine whether or not the municipality is subject to its own zoning laws. And I think there would be some testimony when the application is heard as to whether or not the lease that is in place and the use that's being used on the field right now is consistent with the lease in place and consistent with the zoning for this area. But it's that initial determination as to whether or not the board can determine applications involving municipal property that Mr. Simon wants to address tonight.
Yeah, so, and again, you know, certainly, regardless, we have to come back and have a formal hearing with witnesses, which I didn't bring tonight, an opportunity for cross-examination, and as the chair stated, an opportunity for the public to speak and ask questions with regard to the application. So, in response to...
I'll just interject that.
Please.
I'm not so sure I agree with that point. I appreciate you made it. But if the board determines that it has no ability, one way or the other, to decide whether or not this use, this conditional use, is appropriate and is being used or being used excessively beyond the conditional use, there's really nothing further for the board to determine at that point. In other words, if the board determines that our ordinances don't permit the board to decide applications involving the municipality, then I don't know that there's any sense in hearing a full application. But go ahead.
Okay. Let me get started. So
I'm sorry. Just so I understand, are you saying that jurisdictionally, because the ordinance state on their face that they don't apply to municipal property, and this potentially this board doesn't have jurisdiction over the question? Is that what you're saying, or something different?
In short, I'm saying that, but Mr. Simon is going to tell us why he believes that particular issue is not applicable here.
Okay,
right?
That's. I just wanted to make sure I understood the legal question.
Again. Okay. Yeah.
Thanks.
So, again, the way, and this is just legal argument, the way the application was submitted, it was submitted under what I previously stated is Section 70B of the Municipal Land Use Law. And 70B in the Municipal Land Use Law allows a Board of Adjustment, and those types of applications are exclusively before a Board of Adjustment, such as yourselves, to hear and decide requests for interpretations of either zoning maps or ordinances or for decisions on special questions under which the board is authorized to pass by any zoning ordinance. So basically, if there's an issue as to an interpretation of particular provision or provisions of a zoning ordinance, you are allowed to file what's called a 70B application, which is exclusively, it's not a planning board application, exclusively before the Board of Adjustment. So in this case, getting right to Tom's point that he raised, so you have an ordinance. Your zoning ordinance, of course, is section, 255. There's a provision 32C. And section 32C states, and I'm going to quote, that the township of Cranford and all of its owned and operated buildings, structures, and uses are specifically exempt from the provisions of this article. And when it says this article, what they mean is Article 5, the zoning, or the zoning ordinance for the township. So This ordinance exemption in favor of the township applies to buildings, structures, and uses that are both owned and operated by the Township of Cranford. And what's interesting is that if you pull up the codified version of the ordinance, it actually has a paren, and it goes on to state that nothing in the ordinance would exempt the Township of Cranford from meeting all federal and state regulations. That's under preemption. And that before the development of any property or structures, again, by the Township of Cranford, the Township of Cranford shall apply to the Cranford Planning Board for its non-binding recommendation, and that notice of a hearing with respect to that application be provided to all property owners within 200 feet. So what is the ordinance talking about?
Sorry, Mr. Simon, you were quoting from language.
I'm quoting from section 255-32C.
But then you went beyond that. So
that's all part of the same ordinance. So I'm saying after the statement I read, then there's an open paren, and then what I just read. So
would you mind repeating that? Because I don't have that written.
Sure, I'll go back. So section 255-32C states that the Township of Cranford and all of its owned and operated buildings, structures, and uses are specifically exempt from the provisions of this article, again being Article 5 zoning ordinance. The ordinance then goes on to state that nothing in the ordinance would, this is still in section 32C, nothing in the ordinance would exempt the Township of Cranford from meeting all federal and state regulations, and that before the development of any property or structures, that the Township of Cranford, shall apply to the Cranford Planning Board for its non-binding recommendation, and that notice of a hearing regarding that application sent to all property owners within 200 feet. So,
I just want to be clear. The actual language of what it says, and it's a footnote from 32C, says, editor's note, ordinance number 91-11, meaning it was adopted in 1991, which originally added this subsection, also provided that nothing in the ordinance would exempt the Township of Cranford from meeting all federal and state regulations, and that before the development of any property or structures, the Township of Cranford shall apply to the Cranford Planning Board for its non-binding recommendation, and that notice of hearing with respect to the application shall be given to property owners within 200 feet of the subject property. I quoted that whole thing for the sake of completeness, but also for the sake of saying I didn't go back and look at the 1991 ordinance, so I don't know whether that's in the whereas clause or if it's in the body of the ordinance, and I don't know whether
I'm reading it from the ordinance just like you are, so that's why I wanted to just to add that. And the reason why it will get back to owned and operated for a second, but the language that Mr. Jardim just quoted is telling in terms of the issue that was raised, namely, is the Township of Cranford, and in this case, the CBSL, subject to the Cranford ordinances. So that second part that Tom just read talks about what is commonly referred to as capital projects. So between section 29 and section 31 in the municipal land use law, there's provisions that provide that when a municipality is planning for their capital projects, and there's capital projects that are stated in the planning, in the master plan, excuse me, and there's a definition of capital improvement in your ordinance, which is a government construction project or acquisition of equipment or real property. So it's a government construction project. And when the government is doing a project, the township, and it's expending public funds, then they go to the planning board for what's called commonly a courtesy review under section 31 in the municipal land use law. And presumably, in the master plan, there's this five-year capital review improvement plan as to what the township is going to be spending money on in the future. The reason why I'm stating this and quoting from the language in 32C is that we believe, that it supports the idea that what the exemption is for, the township of Cranford being exempt, is for owned and operated projects by the township of Cranford. And those owned and operated projects by the township of Cranford are exempt from the zoning ordinance, which makes perfect sense because that's why they go to the planning board. They don't go to the zoning board, they go to the planning board for this capital review where they provide, I just did one in Montclair a couple weeks ago for Board of Education. We're doing a project where we present the project in about 20, 30 minutes. You get comments from the planning board to determine to what extent it's consistent or inconsistent with the master plan, and you go on your way. It's not an application seeking an approval for anything because in that case, the Board of Education for their building project was exempt, just like the Township of Cranford would be exempt if they were coming in and they were doing a project on their own property where they were doing something for their own use, in essence. So then you go back to the original language that I quoted, which is that the Township of Cranford in all of its owned and operated, not just owned and operated, buildings, structures, and uses are specifically exempt from parenthetically, the ordinance. So our position is if you look at 32C, both in terms of the language that it's being used, owned and operated, and the fact that it goes on to, whether it's in a paren or not, reference the fact that the Township of Cranford is not exempt from going to the planning board for a capital review, which always would be the case under the municipal land use law, that all those factors, we believe certainly supports the notion and the reason why we applied before to the Board of Adjustment under 70B for an interpretation that in this case, because the fields that are at issue are being used not by the Township of Cranford, but by the Cranford Baseball and Softball League for their own use, regardless of whether there's a lease and there's not a lease, we're not arguing that allows this board, certainly for the limited discussion that we're having here, to retain jurisdiction and hear, once we renotice, and hear the application as an interpretation application. So we believe again that it's not because it's not the Township of Cranford expending their own public funds doing their own thing that would actually result in a capital project, arguably, that this is a organization, a nonprofit organization that has a lease to exclusively use these fields. And because of that, we believe that there's jurisdiction before the board. And that's not getting into whether it's a D1 prohibited use, pre-existing non-conforming use, a conditional use, or otherwise. So that's really, in a nutshell, what the argument, the narrow legal argument is in response to Tom's question to me.
This does feel like legal argument and oral argument. So
yeah, and I don't mean it to
I'm
be.
I'm usually in that position, not this right. position, but I do want to just.
We can switch.
I do want to just add to the board's understanding as well before we maybe get into questions or comments, but not to be too pedantic about it, but so our the township's land development ordinance is set forth in chapter 255. It has 10 articles within it. And the article that Mr. Simon is quoting from is in Article 5, labeled as zoning. And it gets in and talks about the general intent of zoning, the zone districts, use regulations, et cetera. But in addition to the section that Mr. Simon cited at section 255-32, it is important for the board to have an understanding of language that's contained in section 255-35 under supplementary zone district regulations, in particular subsection B7, which says the township of Cranford is exempt from the applicability of this chapter for township properties and public rights of way. Chapter referring to chapter 255 of the land development ordinance. So Mr. Simon is making an argument that because of the owned and operated language in 255-32, that is the reason why the board can hear this application. I'm pointing out for the board that in addition, in that section a couple away from that, 255-35, it doesn't make that distinction between owned and operated. It simply says the township of Cranford is exempt from the applicability of this chapter for township properties and public rights of way. I would also just note for the board's purposes that in the extensive definition section of our ordinance, which is 255-1, there is a definition for recreation, comma, private, and then recreation, comma, public. Recreation, comma, public is defined as facilities operated by the township, county, or other governmental agency, and that's distinguished from a private recreation facility.
So can I just...
Which one would think would apply here, but you have to read that definition in whole, and a definition of a private recreation is facilities operated by a nonprofit organization and open only to bona fide members and guests of some such nonprofit organization. My point is that there is a definition of public recreation facilities operated by the township that distinguishes other types of recreation facilities. And I would say it's important to consider all of those sections in the board's determination.
Thank you, Tom. Couple things. First of all, in terms of section 35, it specifically talks about the township of Cranford, which is consistent 100%, we believe, with section 32C, which we talked about. Second of all, in terms of the definitions in the beginning of the ordinance, there are, you know, in essence, four definitions to be complete of the argument regarding recreational facilities. First of all, there's a definition of recreational facility. I don't think there's any dispute that the league is operating a recreational facility. Then there's a question of whether it's private or public. So as Mr. Jardim stated, private recreation is defined as facilities operated by a nonprofit organization and open only to bona fide members and guests of such nonprofit organization. And that is different from public recreation, which is a facility operated by the township, county, or other governmental agency. So certainly we contend that this is not a public recreation facility because the fields are not operated by the township, they're operated by the CBSL. And they are being operated by a nonprofit organization that falls under the definition of private recreation facility. And I neglected to mention, because I didn't think we would actually go this far, that these properties are all located in the R1 zone. And the R1 zone does not permit private recreation facilities. So in terms of what Mr. Jardim just pointed out, I think it actually only supports our contention. And again, we're just talking about being able to, no pun intended, step up to the plate, right? And you know, just be able to process our application. You know, and look, there's no surprises here, and you all read the application. I mean, you know, these are land use issues. And that is why we have filed before a land use board. You know, a zoning ordinance isn't about, you know, who owns the land. Zoning ordinance is about how land is used, just generally. And that is specifically why we think it's appropriate. You know, we're not trying to hurt anybody by any means, not even close. But we do feel that, you know, from a legal perspective, it is appropriate that an application like this is brought before, in this case, a board of adjustment, and that we be, you know, certainly permitted to proceed with it, however it ends up.
With regard to the recreation definitions, you said there was four, but you only talked about two, right?
Well, so there's recreation facility.
Okay.
Which we, a place where, you know, sports
okay.
are being carried out. That's number one. Then there's a definition of personal recreation, which is doesn't really apply here because that's something where it's located on the same lot as the principal use and to be designed primarily for the occupants, like a tennis court on a single family home.
So you're saying that this facility falls into recreation facility, but neither recreation public nor recreation?
No. It's right. Certainly recreation private.
Why is
it's
that?
It's a facility operated by a nonprofit organization and open only to bona fide members and guests of such nonprofit organization.
That last part is true?
There's a lease between the township and the CBSL, yes.
Right, but that doesn't mean that it's only, like, to me, that would be like a health club, you know, that you only can go to the health club if you're a member, you know.
I don't know. because it says operated by a nonprofit organization. My health club certainly is not a nonprofit organization. And so.
Okay, fair enough. But I'm having trouble with the only allowed in. I don't have the statute in front of me, but only allowed in for members of that organization.
Bona fide members and guests of that nonprofit organization. So CBSL's nonprofit organization, and it has a lease to operate on those fields. I can't come and play on those fields.
But would you agree that, like, I don't have to be invited by CBSL to go watch a game there? Would you agree with that?
Well, not for spectators to be. It's open. The whole point of the private recreation is to use the recreational facility.
Well, I would just want to
okay.
say
I'm responding to Mr. Jardine.
No,
raised
no,
the
no.
issue, and I want to be complete.
I'm trying to understand.
Oh,
so yeah. is it so, Mr. Maybe this is a question for you. Which one do you think it is, and does it matter?
It does matter.
Okay.
I think it's clearly the public. Recreational activity, and it couldn't be otherwise because under state law, municipalities are only allowed to lease real property to duly incorporated nonprofits if it's being used for a public purpose. And that's pursuant to NJSA 48:12-15I, which is specifically written into the lease. And so I would further state, and Ms. Patras, I would love if she would get an opportunity to speak, but she very cogently noted here that this is also on the township's ROSI, its Green Acres roster. And under Green Acres regulations, you can't enter into a long-term lease like this for a private purpose. It has to have a recreational public benefit, right? I mean, you would agree with that understanding of the Green Acres regulations as well, right? You almost have to because there's no way.
Well, I'll say that with regard to the leasing, you're certainly correct in that, you know, leasing it, there's regulations, statutory regulations that you cited to that talk about leasing for a public purpose, but that's distinct from and different from how an ordinance, a local ordinance, is written and how it's interpreted. So I do think that notwithstanding what you're arguing, Tom, I do believe that if you look at the definition section in the ordinance, and the chairwoman asked actually the right question, which is, does it really matter? Well, the reality is that it's an R1 zone, and private recreation, public recreation is not permitted.
Well, but we don't get to that if right. if the land use laws don't apply to it. So that part doesn't really matter yet, right? We're just talking about whether the land use laws govern.
Yeah, and I think certainly under Section 32, Section 35, under the definition section, certainly that because these fields are not being used by, operated by the township, but rather by a nonprofit organization, we contend that it does not exempt the user from the zoning laws of the Township of Cranford. Because otherwise, I can do whatever I want whenever I want.
Well, the township still has control over that property, right?
Right. Can I ask a question?
Of course.
I actually voted for this ordinance.
I voted for this ordinance.
You did.
So I think the issue is not the use of the land. It's more of how it's being used. And that comes clear through the applicant's comments. If you go to the remedy for the noise and things like that, it clearly states that the use to which the lease premises were put during the preceding year, the activities of the league undertaken in furtherance of the public purpose for which this lease was granted. And that is what happens is the township committee has a review of how that land was used in that prior year, and it's for that public purpose. So I don't think I can avoid this. I mean, I think my son in 1986 played here prior to this lease. It's always been ball fields. So it's proper, I think, for the township governing board to, you know, to respond to some of these issues that have been raised. I don't know what they've done. I haven't really followed that, but because that's the remedy in the lease, and it's been, as far as I understood, followed all these years. If I recall some instances where things were changed, but so the question is: isn't the remedy that's in the lease here the township committee?
Well,
that was this, not for me.
Yeah, was that was that Dan for me? I guess.
Yeah.
So I'm not asking this board. I know, as a board of adjustment attorney myself, in a number of communities. I'm not asking this board to interpret the meaning of a lease or enforcement of a particular lease provision. Okay. We're here, as I stated, specifically about a ordinance interpretation issue, not a lease interpretation issue. Whether I agree or disagree, that's why we're here. We've made our contention that we don't believe that, or that we believe that because this particular use by nonprofit organization is not being used by the township, it's not being operated by the township, that this board has jurisdiction to hear the application.
So. I actually have a question too. So was a Section 31 review, did one occur when the fields were developed and the structure was built there in front of the planning board? Or do we know the answer to that? Because that would have some relevance here, right?
Well,
it's a good question.
I mean, they were developed, Dan, so long ago. I mean, I played there as a...
Right, and I would say whether or not it did or it didn't is, in my mind, respectfully, not, you know, let me put it a different way. If things have been done incorrectly through no one's fault in the past regarding how a particular use is being treated in a particular community, that doesn't mean that whatever was done in the past should continue to be done. We took a look at this ordinance fresh based on Ms. Belanius' law and led to our conclusions that we are permitted to make an application for 70B for an interpretation before the Board of Adjustment. And that's all I can kind of tell you. And just looking at the ordinance and the ordinance language and what we believe the intent is, looking at and the fact that there's a distinction, you know, in our mind between, you know, having a private nonprofit organization conduct the operation and having the township itself conduct the operation.
When Mr. Jardine mentioned 255-35B7 and that how that says that the township properties are exempt from that chapter, what is your response to that?
It says the township is exempt from its. So in other words, that assumes, and it goes with 32, I think, in terms of being consistent, that if it is a owned and operated road, right-of-way, sidewalk, whatever it is, it's not intended in 35 that, hey, look, if the township decides to lease or license a particular use, that all of a sudden that user is exempt from the ordinance provisions just by virtue of that lease document.
What it actually says is the Township of Cranford is exempt from the applicability of this chapter for township properties and public rights of way.
Right, right. The township is exempt, not the private entity.
I see what you're saying.
Can I ask a question? Sorry.
Of course.
And all the attorneys in the room, I appreciate everything you guys do. Thank you.
Sorry.
I just, like, I'm looking at your application, and you have in here, had the CVSL complied with the lease provision, the annual review by the township committee would have revealed the dramatic and unreasonable increase in the number of games played at the fields. Right? So, and I got the application, I reviewed everything from us, but, like, has this gone before the township? Like, I know that you're here speaking to us saying that we have, like, you want us to have ownership of this and to rule on this, but, like, has the township ruled on this or given any opinion on this? Are you aware?
Not that I'm aware.
Does it seem more reasonable to go before the town who has the lease and have that conversation first before coming to a board that doesn't have anything to do with that lease, at least in the past, before you come to us and ask us to do that?
Yeah, well, I'll answer it this way. I don't think that, fair question, certainly. I don't think that whether the township would be willing to discuss the lease provisions has any impact per se in terms of the legality of us filing the application. That being said, be happy to speak to the township.
Yeah, I just, absolutely. Like, I mean, once again, no offense to the attorneys in the room, throw that out for a second. Right. Go have the conversation before we go before the board and ask us to review this.
Happy to do that. And in fact, you know, because we have to renotice anyway, happy to have the conversation in the interim. Please do. And if the board prefers, just put on a different hat for a second, that maybe if that's the path that the board is recommending, of course, without prejudice to anyone, then what I may then ask is that, because we have to renotice anyway, that maybe we defer any further discussion on what we're talking about tonight until the next meeting, and then if I have an opportunity in the interim, would be happy to speak to the township.
If I'm out of place, just let me know, Chair. I just, you know, I was speaking from my my perspective on that.
Oh, that's fine.
Okay.
Yeah. Are you suggesting that you don't want the board to decide this sort of?
Well, I don't have the power to say to decide or not decide.
I'm asking what you're asking. That's all.
Yes. So, it may be in to sort of move things along. It may be in everyone's best interest if that's the path chosen.
Okay.
I think that would be a healthy and maybe even productive step as well.
Yep. I would support that being a reasonable and rational direction, to be honest with you.
Happy to do it.
Yeah, and it may expedite things, may find a quicker resolution, because reading in between all the lines in the application, I don't think the applicant's real desire is so much the zoning issues as it is the, you know, troubling issues that they've stated in their application, right? So if those could be settled, it may save them a lot of time and make a better resolution. My humble opinion.
I agree with that.
I'm nodding my head as well.
Okay. All right.
All right. So it sounds like the board is fine with not making this decision tonight about this sort of, I don't know what we call it, but getting me in the door, basically, jurisdictional, I would say, issue.
It is.
What? Should we take a vote on that?
No. All I would ask is that we can have another date. You know, I have to renotice, so you don't even have to announce it. I just want a date so that I can renotice should I need to.
Does that make sense?
No, I'm not. Okay.
Do you want one that soon? I'm just asking.
Sorry?
Do you want one that soon?
I mean, I guess I can always write a letter and ask that it be further carried if we need to further carry. Is that okay?
That's fine.
That's June 10th? Very good. Okay. Thank you.
So I need to make an announcement that this application is being carried to June 10th?
being June 10th, and new notice will be provided.
Oh, okay. So I guess I don't have to make an announcement.
Yes.
Okay. Notice
thank
is
you.
Provided. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Simon.
Okay, we'll move on to the second application. Mr. Lucas, can you read it, please?
This is application ZBA 23-017, applicant J. Tan and M. Togg LLC, owner J. Tan and M. Togg and Real Strong Fuel. 545A Lexington Avenue and 547-549 Lexington Avenue, block 457, lots 8 and 9, R1 zone. The applicant is requesting a D1 use variance to construct an age-restricted townhouse development consisting of 23 residential units, 20 market rate, and 3 affordable, spread throughout 5 three-story townhouse buildings. The applicant is also proposing surface and garage parking, fencing, and landscaping improvements. This is a bifurcated application.
Thank you.
Gary Goodman on behalf of the applicant.
Go ahead and proceed.
Yeah, good evening. Good to see you in live, as opposed to Zoom or whatever. So anybody ever wonder what law school was like the last half hour? Sorry, indicated. The applicant is named J. Tan and M. Togg. The person behind it, the developer, is Victor Venegra, who is here this evening. Basically, we're here because the Real Strong Fuel Company that's been in existence since 1925, the family has decided to retire. They're out of the business. This is a property that predates the zoning ordinance of the Township of Cranford. There have been actually some municipal cases that have allowed different industrial uses on the property. In any regard, the applicant tonight, Mr. Venegra, is appearing here tonight to ask for a bifurcated application to allow for the age-restricted, handicap-adaptable housing that he proposes. Bifurcated in the sense that we are looking for an affirmative vote to allow this use, but also accompanying the use is the density, the 23 units that he is proposing. So although we are not here for site plan, we're not here for variances, we are presenting to the board the information that you would see in a site plan. And if you granted us the use variance for this use and for this size, we would come back for the a site plan. So when you listen to the evidence and the testimony, I want you to consider it in its totality, because this is a window of opportunity to fill a need that the town has. If you look through our master plan focuses on age-restricted, handicap-adaptable housing. We don't have any areas in this community that can function as townhouse development areas. When our planner comes up here, she will support that with testimony with regard to what townhouse land exists in the community. We have tonight Mr. Venegra, we have our planner, Catherine Sarmad, we have Betsy Dolan, our traffic engineer, once again, it's bifurcated, but we are looking for you to give consideration to the totality of the application and to look at this as a 23-unit townhouse development. Mr. Venegra will be able to walk you through what the site looks like in terms of the 5 three-story buildings. You'll see the parking. You will see, basically, he'll be able to tell you about the architectural, and I think you will get a general idea of, more a specific idea of what he proposes. So, you know, if you have it in your mind that, man, maybe townhouses are good and we could see 6 townhouses there, that really, you know, isn't going to help the issue here. The owners of the property need to sell it. If it's not for this use, then perhaps as the fourth round of affordable housing, we'll get some developer that's looking for something that everybody doesn't like, or we'll get an industrial truck user, and we'll get another use that nobody likes. But we're not here to talk about what could happen as much as what we want to happen here. And it's a use that I think, as we baby boomers age in place and can't walk stairs anymore and are looking for alternatives to stay in town, I believe this meets that need. I'd like to call Victor Venegra.
Can I just ask a question first? I believe that, you know, recently there were changes made to the application, correct?
I didn't really hear that. Could you say it again? I'm sorry.
Recently there were changes made, yes, to the application. Is it safe to say that you're done making changes, so we should be looking at what has been provided to us and be deciding based on that?
Yes, good question. And I think my witness is in the best position to answer that.
Okay, great. Thank you.
I need this. Yeah, I can use this. Thank you.
He's going to ask you questions.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
I guess you got to state your name, Victor.
Okay.
That's where I'm in.
Tom?
Yes. If you raise your right hand, sort of testimony you'll give this evening
will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God.
I do. My name is Victor, middle initial E, last name Venegra, V-I-N-E-G-R-A. And I'm with the firm of Harbor Consultants, which is located at 320 North Avenue East in Cranford, New Jersey. We've been there for over 30 years. I'm an engineer, land surveyor, and professional planner in the state of New Jersey. All my licenses are in good standing, and I have testified before this board in all three disciplines. I do have a separate planner here tonight who does municipal planning and affordable housing planning, Catherine Sarmed. So she's going to really go into the particulars of planning in this. I'm just going to give you an overview. I'm 1% owner of JTAM. My wife is the majority owner of the company. And we own a small segment, one of the lots in question. And I'll go into, you know, what we're looking to do here.
Why don't you answer the chairwoman's first question, which was, are you planning on making any changes?
Not at this time, unless a change may come up from discussions with the boards. But the change that was made after meetings with the residents. So there was a meeting. It wasn't an official meeting. It was a meeting at the Cranford Community Center. I did send a formal letter to the people within 200 feet and people that did show up to the last Zoom meeting that we had. I took the list from the Zoom. And a lot of people on that list were not from the neighborhood, but I did notify them. I notified everyone within 200 feet, and we had a little meeting. It lasted around 2.5 hours, and at that meeting, we made some changes to the plan based on discussions with the neighbors.
Okay. One of the reasons why I asked that question is I noticed in our planner's report, there was a lot of suggestions made, and I presume that we're going to review those during these meetings, and we've just had a lot of applications in the past where once we do that, then the applicants want to make changes, substantial changes to the applications, and then we find that we're sort of redoing hearings. So I just wanted to...
I'm pretty confident with the plan that we've done. It was based on, we did have a DRC. I made some changes from the DRC. We moved the building further away from the railroad line. I did incorporate some of those items, but then I did also incorporate items from the residents because they are the people in the neighborhood within 200 feet, and they had some concerns.
Okay.
So that's why you have a hybrid here, you know, because, again, the planner wrote comments, but, you know, it's just they're going over the ordinance. This does not follow the ordinance for this zone. It's a single-family zone.
Okay. Go ahead and proceed.
You want to show the board what you have in terms of the existing conditions here?
First, real quick, I've done some small amount of building. I've done some of these similar townhouse units.
I have built in Cranford before. I purchased property from the municipality on Myrtle Avenue. I've been before that board. Cleaned it up. It had some contaminant. That wasn't contaminated. It had a historic fill. People were dumping there. It was an old sign. It was an old billboard sign on the Linden Cranford border. I purchased that from the town, cleaned it up, had a clean environmental on that, and constructed a single family home in Cranford on that. And I've also built my office and a couple other items. So I ended up with this piece because actually someone called me up from the construction department years ago and said, hey, we have our, the people think it's contaminated. They're not sure. It's an old, it was an old construction yard with a Quonset hut on it. Can you look at it? I went over and looked at it and did some environmental testing, got a clean bill of health on it, took out some of the trash that was there, demoed the building, and it's used as a commercial yard. So I've always owned this piece for almost 10 years now. In fact, I came before the board with this piece a number of years ago. Never acted on that approval, and owned this piece and just use it as a yard that what it was the old use.
Just to clarify, Victor, 1.5 acres is the real strong property, correct?
Yes.
You own the adjacent parcel, and that's approximately 0.2 acres.
Yeah, it's not much. So the existing owner is Peter Crane. Peter, the Crane family, all the Crane families from behind here, they've been in Cranford forever. It's been this construction, HVAC, coal, oil distribution for over 100 years. Peter dropped by my office the other day, dropped off some old photos. So item one is first, I guess it's at least 100, I think it's over 100 years old. It shows the train line here, shows it was some coal bins, the oil tanks, Lexington Avenue, and it shows no one home on Lexington, and the rest were orchards or farms. So I guess Peter might donate these photos to Cranford if they want for historical reasons. Also, he gave, you can see Real Strong goes back quite a way in Cranford. A real strong vehicle. This is the operation where they would take in coal. It was a separate railroad spur, so coal was delivered by a railroad car, delivered to these silos, stored in the silos and delivered. Then he went also into the heating oil business. And you can see this is quite some time ago. So this particular parcel predates your ordinance. So the industrial use on this and the commercial use on this predates the ordinance, so it predates all the whatever we write in the ordinance after that. This is grandfathered. So as you can see here, this is the scale which still exists. We're looking at it from Lexington, the hut that was demolished, and those were the coal bins. And this is from, this view is from Lexington. And this is another aerial view looking from the railroad tracks. And that's, again, Real Strong later on. They went into the HVAC business. He had contractors out there. So it was, it's been for over 100 years, this type of facility. So so when I talked to the owner, when he sold the business to the heating oil business and the HVAC business to another user, and he came to me, he said, I want to sell the land, but I got some offers for commercial property. And I said, well, if you have offers, I have the back piece. We probably combine them and sell them for commercial property. And I said, well, instead of going for commercial, you know, continuing that use, I don't think it's the best use for the property. It's in a residential zone. It's directly across the street from residential properties, all single family. Everything that abuts it except for the railroad is single family residential. So I said, you know, we had excellent luck in the adjoining municipality with age-restricted senior housing. Townhouse with adaptable ADA capabilities with private elevators. So I said, you know, the adjoining town has built, the first project was Garwood Point. That has 44 age-restricted senior townhomes with private elevators. They are the number one selling real estate in the municipality at the time. That was 20 years ago. Over time, that project became a huge success. Almost no turnover. I think, and I believe from talking to the residents, in 15 years, they've only had 3 sales. In that 15 years, the 3 sales are because people passed away. So it's an age-in-place design. These buildings are designed to age in place. Private elevators, 3 bedrooms, some are 3, some are 2. The bottom is set up so you have a full bathroom, so in case you have a live-in aide. So these are really designed for age-in-place, which is similar to what Garwood has done. And again, they became very successful. There's a project similar, very similar, I'm going to show you, on 4th Avenue in Garwood, which are, right now, they're five constructed, they're all sold, age-restricted townhouses. This is where we got the concept from. So I talked to Peter, the owner of Real Strong, and said, I think this is a good concept. Right now, Cranford doesn't have anything like it, and it's selling well. We're also the planners for Scotch Plains. Shack and Maxon has done very well. They're bedroom down. So if you're older, you have a bedroom on the first floor. These are not. These units here are not bedroom down. They're elevated, so you have elevator on all three floors. Even if you're healthy, you may not want to carry groceries. Put the groceries in the elevator, hit the button. But if your spouse becomes injured or you as you age, you have an issue with stairs, this is a facility that's designed, again, aging in place, we call it, and it's for sale. Very few of these are not rental units. So these are for people who want to sell their home, don't want any more maintenance, sell their home for whatever price they get, and they move in here and they stay within Cranford. We do have a witness here tonight who did buy one of the units in the adjoining municipality. She has grandkids in Cranford, and she just wants to, she took, in discussions with her, it said it took her about 2 years to find the right housing for her and her husband. Her husband has some disabilities. So that's where these concepts have come from. They're derived from firsthand knowledge of talking to people that do buy these units, and it comes from looking at this property. This property in particular does have, it had a small oil leak from one of the oil tanks. It's being remediated. And normally with NJDEP, there's two forms of remediation. There's industrial and there's residential. The residential cleanup levels are much higher. So right now, Mr. Crane, he's getting an environmental cleanup of the site to the residential standards, because that's what my contract says. It has to be done not per industrial standards, but for residential standards. So right now he has what's called an LSRP at the site doing monitoring wells and doing the cleanup of a small spill from an underground oil tank. Besides that, we've had the site tested by an outside agency that I paid for to analyze. Mr. Crane has his own engineer, environmental engineer. I contracted with a separate environmental engineer to go over the entire site. Because whenever you have a railroad involved, you have to worry about things like coal, there's numerous things. We've had it tested environmentally, and the small little areas that we had cleaned up, so we're pretty satisfied that the site, it has to be, get a DEP, no further action, to be cleaned up to residential standards, so it won't be industrial standards. So that's how we're working with the site now. Mr. Crane has since closed the business. He phased down. The site used to be very busy because all the spaces were occupied, leased, or he had businesses running out of there. Over time, because he had to sell the businesses, he eventually did not renew the contracts for the landscapers and the HVAC people that were there. So it's pretty quiet now, but but at one time it did have, when I first bought it, it was quite busy of a facility. So I'll go into the rendering. Gotta give some time. Let me try aerial view. Yeah, I'll double click it again. Come on. Here we go. So this is the site in question. You can see this is Lexington Avenue. There's this flag lot here. Mr. Mike Marcus lives at this facility. He has a flag lot with a driveway that goes down to Lexington Avenue. So this is Real Strong Fuel. These are the oil containment tanks here. These are garages. There's a single family home here, an office, truck parking along here and here, and the access is out Lexington Avenue. We're looking to take this particular property and construct five buildings, and we'll go into that rendering.
Is that an exhibit?
Yes, it is.
Okay, so A1?
That'll be, I guess the photos could be A1, and this could be A2.
And describe that to me again, Victor.
A1 would be the historical photos,
yep.
Supplied
A2.
By Peter Crane. A2 is the aerial Google aerial view of the site in question? This is a architectural view of Lexington. These type of buildings, they will be first floor garage with a small bonus room in the back with a full bathroom. I'll go into that in more detail later. The second level is dining room, living room, dining room, and the kitchen. Third floor is either two or three bedroom with full bath. So normally with these type of units, they're at grade. The driveway is flush, so when you pull in, and say the same thing with the first floor, with the lower level, so when you pull in your vehicle, it's ADA for if you need a walker or whatever, you get it into your garage, the garage is flush, you have, by code, you have to have a small gap from your garage to the living quarters, you make that code, you have a small ramp there, and then you have a private elevator right off to your right. So if you come in, you get out of your vehicle, you get out of the garage because of fire code, you go into the living quarters, you press the button, it's a small manual elevator, large enough for a wheelchair. You design them for wheelchair accessibility to get a 30-inch wheelchair in there. And then you can have access to the second floor and the third floor to bedroom units.
And
that
is
would
that
be
an
A3.
Yeah.
And that's an architectural rendering view from Lexington Avenue. Okay. A4, let me mark this. This is a rendering of your sheet, it should be your sheet 3. A4 depicts the existing single family home that exists in the rear, this long asphalt driveway. These are the buildings here. This is where there's a garage. This garage is here now. There's an office here now. The oil tanks are here. This is all the area along the railroad tracks is all parking right now. It's all gravel and broken asphalt. So almost this whole area that I'm showing from here to here is currently impervious material. All this area is impervious. So what would happen to build this site, you would have to remove all this impervious, obviously, grind that up and cart it off. This is a water quality basins and green infrastructure will be utilized. So this is being designed,
So basically, Victor, what separates what you're showing the board now and what you would show them in site plan is like stormwater management, the deep engineering that they don't see.
Mr. Goodman, you have to use the mic. Okay.
Yes. What the reason we're bifurcated is a couple. We're looking for input from the board and from the public. You know, I'm an engineer. We have a 20-person engineering firm, so I can put my engineers to engineer this. But if it's a fluid application, we're looking at removing some impervious, moving this building after I meet with the residents, you know, after I meet with the board, we may want to tweak it a little bit. This is something that's not permitted in the zone. It's not really anywhere in your ordinance for age-restricted senior townhouses. So this is something that's a little fluid. So that's why I'm here. But we have looked at it. My engineers looked at the site. It is buildable in this fashion. We are removing impervious, and we can build detention basins. It's just removal of the soil and planting we have grass areas and such. So I want to zoom in more. There you go. A little too fast. So building one would be four units. You pull in two-car garage, two in the driveway. Again, this is the garage area, and you have that room in the back, and the elevator's here, goes up to the second floor. Building two is a little bit different. It's the end units or the bigger units. The middle three units only have a one-car garage. They're a little narrower to fit them in and a little less expensive, less square footage. The end units are not small buildings. These are over 2,100 square foot. A livable space. They're pretty large. So We wanted to have a mix, some narrower interior units that are two-bedroom. We show building two over here, building two twice, okay, interesting. Again, two end units that are larger, and then this is the same type of building type two are here and here, they're the same building type. Building type four has three units that are market rate, and then apartments that are stacked. Three apartments, one on the first floor, one on the second floor, one on the third floor, and these will be affordable housing to help for, because this is going to be a COA type project to satisfy the affordable housing component. And the last unit, which is a type three building, has two end units which have the two-car garage, one narrow, a middle unit. The middle units are 18 feet wide, which is a one-car garage, but two in front of the driveway. We're overparked. We know we're overparked. But in the parking areas off to the side, we want to use grass pavers, which are the concrete pavers with the grass that grows in between that are permeable. The reason it's a little overparked is after meeting with the residents, that was their one of their, they have a number of concerns. Well, one is density. Number two was cleaning up of the site to residential standards and removal of the area. Obviously, a number of them are here. They are very concerned, which is good. I mean, that would be too. But one thing they brought up was, could you have additional parking? So we overparked it because people can pull in a driveway, but then you have, again, almost every unit has four parking spaces, which is above the requirement. We put overflow spaces off to the side, again, so someone, you have a visitor or someone staying over overnight that doesn't block the driveway. We added two here, and two at the front. That doesn't show in your rendering, but it shows up at a site plan. Oh, there you are. So we put two small ones here. It's actually related to the unit. It's kind of a long walk. It's something the residents wanted, and I felt okay. I normally don't like having a double unit back up onto a roadway, but it's at the end of a roadway, so there's no passing by vehicle. There's only one owner on this side of the property over here. So as you look on our site plan on the cover sheet, and as your planner pointed out, we have 82 spaces and we're only required to have approximately 53. But any overflow parking I have using these permeable pavers, I have used them in myself at my office here in Cranford. They're fantastic for draining water. They're terrible for women's shoes. So I don't want to place these pavers in front of someone's driveway. It will wreck their shoes. I have it there, again, but as far as overflow parking, as in here, 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 and here, the permeable pavers work excellent. They work, in fact, I think, better than detention basins that I've installed throughout Cranford, because we're bringing in fresh stone, aerated topsoil, and it helps evaporation, not just in permeability into the soil. I find on a warm day, the water, like, we get great water relief from evaporation from these items. So we incorporated that. It's part of green infrastructure, I believe, but I didn't want to incorporate that directly in front of people's driveways, because they are a little tough to snowplow, they're a little tougher to maintain, and they're rougher on your shoes. But anywhere we can, we're using the permeable pavers. The site, as you see here, is still less, I feel, than the impervious coverage there now. About a third, maybe half the impervious coverage there is now gravel. Your ordinance says, well, gravel is somewhat permeable. This gravel has been there for 100 years. It's rock hard. I'm going to have a soil scientist study the gravel that's out there to give you a report how rock hard it is, because trucks have been driving over for over 100 years. So it's quite impermeable now. Also part of this plan is a walkway around the entire facility for the residents, a vegetable garden and flower garden in the back with a shed, some tables and chairs, some benches, so that you could walk around the site. Again, this is coming from people that we've spoken to and people that live in these units now, of something they're looking for. They don't want to maintain a backyard. And again, these walking paths are not for the general public, they're just for people that live here. So you're not gonna have a ton of people walking behind your property, it's just your residents, because this is all common space anyway, because you're gonna own your property, but you don't own the land. This is a townhouse where you own only under your dwelling unit. It was pointed out by your planner that there's no decks on this building type one. That was done on purpose. The decks were there originally. We removed these decks because they were the closest one to this dwelling unit here. And one of the requests of the residents were that, hey, you know what? If anything, if you can do it, we don't mind a sliding door with maybe a Juliet balcony there, but we don't want people sitting out beside looking at my house directly down in my backyard. So I think what we decided to do is remove those, and we could put Juliet balconies in there. It's just something to get airflow, natural air into the unit, get cross breeze through the unit without having people congregating back here.
Victor, the distance from the right-of-way, the railroad, and how does that compare with similar developments that are built along the railroad?
Yeah, right now I am the engineer and planner for a number of municipalities along this route. Right now we manage a number of towns, Garwood, Elizabeth, Hillside, Kenilworth, Berkeley Heights. So we looked into that. So the requirements, and I also have, I'll bring it the next one of the letters. I have some engineers I deal with that work for transporting materials through the rails. So we looked in briefly. We have distance from building number three, with this building here, is 70 feet from the rail track and 31 feet from the right-of-way. This building four is 65 feet from the rail track and 25 feet from the right-of-way. Your ordinance requires 100 feet. So, okay, we have to look at that ordinance now. So contacted, again, an associate engineer that works for the railroad, and he said, I said, is there a federal requirement? He said, no. I go, is there a state requirement? He goes, no. He goes, we're looking into the NFPA guidelines, the fire department's guidelines. He goes, there's no guidelines for proximity to the railroad tracks. He goes, I said, what is carried on these rails? Is that the same material that's carried over the road? So he goes, yes, because it was the same material that's going on Highway 28 in front of my office is the same material being shipped on this rail, just in a larger quantity. So I did see the letter from your fire subcode. It wasn't your fire chief, and I'm not going to get into that letter tonight, but I'm going to bring in a fire expert to testify about this layout. So I deal a lot with fire experts because I work for a lot of municipalities, and I work for some municipalities with large fire departments who handle railroad fires, airport fires, fires at terminals. So I will bring at the next hearing, because I don't think we're going to vote tonight, I'm going to bring a fire expert from a fire department in Union County. So,
yeah, Mr. Vernanger, one other thing to have them address would be Battalion Chief Lubin also referred to the pipeline, right, that is in that area too. So if you could,
yeah,
because that's in one of our memos as well.
Yeah, that he did bring that up, so we looked at that, and that's why there was another revision done. The fire chief, so we went out and as-built to the location of the pipeline, and we're over 50 feet from that pipeline, which is the recommendation of the National Petroleum Institute. It's a recommendation, not a code, but we meet the recommendation of the National Petroleum Institute for a 50-foot separation between a residential dwelling and a pipeline, and we meet that. So again, I did some studies after that input. Also, these are sprinklered buildings. They will be fully sprinklered, occupied. All three floors will be sprinkler units with a small sprinkler room in each building. That's a heated sprinkler room for that. Also, there will be hydrants installed. We will meet with the fire department. If this board so deems fit that this use fits the zone, we'll meet with the fire department, place hydrants. We actually did a turning radius template on the plan showing a fire engine from Cranford could come in. That's what this backup area is. on the pavers. They could back in and pull out. So a fire vehicle can access, pull in this way, back in, and then pull back out along Lexington. We have adequate access for that. So, and with also was, if there is approval, there will probably most likely in a job of this side, there'll be at least two hydrants. I'd say probably one here and one here for access. So there's no, at no instance on this site, there would be any more than three, as per NFPA guidelines, drag length of 300 feet. So I think they're probably going to be somewhere around 200 or less, probably 150. So I know the code is, I think it's 300 to 250 feet of hose length drag. We'll be below that, well below that. Because we have good water out here, but before we connect that, we will have a fire hydrant test by New Jersey American Water. They'll give us what their pressures are. The hydrant system will be designed per their pressure, and also the sprinkler system will be designed per their pressures. So, but to go back on the railroad, some of the properties within the municipality, on Eastman Place over there, where Track 6 Coffee is, they're right up on a property line. They're building 0 feet from the railroad right away, and they're 26 feet from the tracks. We're over 70 feet from the tracks. Cranford Commons is 4 South Avenue, the garage building. The building is 28 feet from the railroad tracks to the tracks, and the 20 feet from the right-of-way. We're much farther, and that's the four-story Cranford Commons building. Woodmont on South Avenue is 60 feet from the tracks. We're 70, and they're 35 feet from the right-of-way, and we're roughly 25. So there are, and there's a number of single families along Georgia Street that are very similar to what we're matching. On Lexington, there's a home that's very close at the end of Lexington, and Alan O'Keel Place has a structure that's with the same as ours, about 70 feet from the railroad tracks and 30 feet from the right-of-way. So it's not uncommon for this board or one of Cranford's boards or the redevelopment plan to specify to go less than 100 feet in your ordinance. It has happened in the past, and there's a number of structures built to that code.
Also, Victor, you talk... You got two things to your ask. You're asking for a townhouse use, but you're also asking for 23 units density. Can you comment with regard to how the density on this project compares with some of the other projects that have been approved in Cranford?
Well, it's just not Cranford. It's everywhere. Our firm and Catherine is here tonight, must represent, I would say, 15 municipalities. We do affordable housing for a number of municipalities. We do engineering for a number of municipalities. So we understand the board process, and that I also understand that we're coming in here and we're going to supply the affordable housing. We want to talk with your planner about we might increase without increasing the footprint, maybe decreasing the width of a couple of buildings and adding a couple more affordable units in there. This becomes an affordable project. This helps the municipality meet its affordable guidelines. So we're looking to help the town meet those guidelines while building a for sale product. And out of, you know, I must have been involved in, I don't know, 8,000, 15,000 apartment building complexes. Not one was for sale. Not one that I know along this Raritan Trail are a for-sale product. The builders do not build a for-sale product. Why? They only have to do a 15% set-aside for-sale product. Well, it's for sale. I mean, a 15% set-aside for rentals, but you do a 20% set-aside for sale. It's skewed in a certain direction. My planner is going to go more into that. This is a for-sale product. It's not like anything we've seen, I think I've seen, along this route. The density of 14 units an acre is, in my opinion, for affordable housing project, quite low. Normally, they're somewhere in the range of high 20s to 30 at a minimum, and then they go up from there. So most of the projects in Cranford, and Catherine's going to go to it, like Woodmont is 33 units an acre, Crossings 38 units an acre, Riverfront, 47 units an acre. We're 14 units an acre, and this is for sale. So second hat I have is I do what's called an exit study. Vermella was very key. We helped work with the builders of Vermella. They're getting some high rents on the upper levels. And I ask, you know, and say the thing with Riverwalk. I mean, I was the original engineer on Woodmont Station. And I ask people that move in there, you know, who live there, where are you? Who are you? And what we're finding is half, more than half, are people 55 and older who sold their homes and are renting. And they put their furniture in storage, and they're there because whatever, they don't want to take care of a home anymore. They got the market was good. They got a good price for the house, and they sell their home. The other half were people who we found are moving back into the area, maybe lived in Hoboken, Jersey City, now having kids. It's easier to raise kids in this area. That's what I'm finding from interviewing people in Scotch Plains, Berkeley Heights. What's the dynamic? So any facility that where it's for sale, such as this first phase in Garwood, the units have all sold out. They've all sold out. Again, someone's here tonight. I hope to get enough time for to get her up to speak. And what we're finding, the buyers, more than 50% of the buyers, someone in the household has a health issue that cannot negotiate theirs. So that is something we're also looking to do here, because it makes sense. If you're building a three-story 55 and older complex, who wants to go up the three flights of steps? Even if you're healthy enough, you don't want to carry, again, your groceries. You don't want to move a end table. You slide it into the elevator, you press the button. So that is how this product got derived. The layout was from investigation and also with some discussions with the neighbors. And from being an engineer for over 40 years, you know, I've worked on thousands of these. Mostly in Monmouth County, though. Most of these in Monmouth and Middlesex counties. There's not a lot of townhouse units in Union County because most towns don't have a townhouse zone. The town next door has we have 44, the first project, and now another 10 were approved, actually nine. So there's 53 townhouse for sale units, and they're wildly successful. Again, I stated that before. And we're finding that people who are coming to this area who don't want to rent, they want to lock in their rent, because even rent is a one-year lease. So 1 year could be $3,000 and they can move your rent up. They want to hold their furniture, they want to keep their paintings, they want their daughter, even though the daughter doesn't live there anymore, they're empty nesters, they want to have their daughter visit, their grandkids visit. There's no product out there right now for that. Now, so that was this idea, to take an industrial site that's been heavy industrial for 100 years, not let it go back to industrial, convert it into something that I feel is something needed in the area, and that's, again, a for sale component. Granted, it's not the greatest location. It's along a railroad track. But my office is along a railroad track. My office is approximately 90 feet from the railroad track. I hear the train come by. But as long as the trains are moving slow, I'd rather listen to the train on my office than listen to North Avenue. North Avenue is much louder. So, you know, it's again. I'm showing you my faults. It's not the greatest because of train movements for these units along the railroad track. But there are thousands of homes and thousands of apartments along the same railroad track. You go down further down into Westfield. My father-in-law used to live with the Lambert's Mill Road apartments. They're very close to the railroad tracks, and there's hundreds of units there. So you zoom back on Google Earth and just go along this rail line, you'll see nothing but apartments in Clark, Westfield, elsewhere along the same line. So this is not uncommon for having multifamily zoned along this rail line.
Maybe at this point, Victor, you open it up to questions to the board. Take a little break here.
Okay.
Your questions from the board?
I have a question. Actually, it might be for Mr. Jardine, if you could explain to us. What are the percentages for affordable housing? So there's 23 units, 20 of them market value, 3 are affordable. What is the percentage that are required for those types of units?
Correct. It's for rentals, it's a 15% set aside, and for condos or for sale, it's 20%.
Okay. So 20%. So Shouldn't the number for affordable housing be higher then?
That's why we're here tonight. I think my experience is the rental would be a better option, because if you're 55 and older already, you want to, if you qualify for affordable housing, you would want your income to go towards living, not a down payment, in my opinion. We do a lot of this. I do a lot of affordable housing with affordable housing companies. Very few are for sale.
So just to be clear, all of it would be for sale except for the affordable housing.
I'd like the affordable housing to be rent controlled, affordable housing, but rented. So the homeowners association would be responsible for that units as far as the exterior, and the homeowners association would rent out the units. That, I think, would be the better guys, because we've done co-ops. I've done co-ops in the past. I've done affordable housing co-ops in Rahway, and the bankruptcy rates were very high. Sometimes the people buy it, and then they go bankrupt in their purchase. Now the homeowners association is responsible for the person who lives in that unit. I think it would be burdensome to the people that live here if the units were sold. I think it's smarter to rent the affordable housings.
So the affordable units would also be age restricted?
Yes, yes.
Then another question, the affordable units, so those are not gonna be up to the same standard as the other units? They don't have—
No, they're smaller, they don't have—
They're smaller, they don't have the garages, like with the overhangs to them. What are they?
So, there'll be overhangs, but there'll be no garage. The exterior would look the same, except for there'll be no garage.
Sorry.
And my planner, who does affordable housing, specializes in it, she will testify as far as what the requirements, the state requirements are on that.
So there's also no elevator either, right?
Excuse me?
Is there an elevator in the affordable units?
Not right now, no, because again, we're— the issue with an elevator, once you go from a single family user elevator to multiple users, the code changes dramatically, so does the fire codes. And I think that would also be very burdensome on the homeowners association, taking care of a larger elevator. The individual homeowner will be taking care of their own private elevator, but right now we're not proposing an elevator for the three flats.
So there might be somebody who's older on the second or third floor that wouldn't have an elevator.
And that would also have to weigh into the renter. Again, it goes into the rental. The first floor can be fully ADA compliant. Second floor, third floor is going to have to be a healthier renter.
Well, doesn't that go against what you were saying to us earlier, that it's— you want to have the accessibility for all these folks, the senior, the assisted living or senior facility? I mean, it just seems odd that the affordable housing wouldn't have the elevators that would be similar to all the other units.
I'd have to do some more research in there. The problem, again, I talked to the elevator, the manufacturers, and once you go to a multi-user elevator, it's a whole other set of requirements.
Okay. I mean, so you're going to look into that?
Excuse me?
You're going to look into that with the—
I looked into that already. I could look into it again, or I could look into doing maybe— I like this layout, tightening the units, maybe do two flats on top of each other and two flats next to it, so it's only one set of steps. I want to look into different things, but I want to keep this same envelope, and I want to keep it 20 market rate units. The affordable, if it's three or four, we'll work that out, but it would still be 20 market rate units at this layout, not a bigger layout, not a change. And so we could look into it. I don't think it's a problem with a one-story walk-up. The two-level walk-up, it's a little much, so we can look into that.
Okay. Oh, we want to hear it. We want to hear it, Gru.
It's not on. But if we to go into the affordable housing aspect of it, I do have an expert in it, so I'm just going into the architectural style right now.
Are you aware that whether it's per Cranford code, whether it's rental or owner occupied or HOA, the requirement is 20% regardless. There's not 15% for rental.
Yeah, I was talking with my planner. I wasn't aware originally, but she updated me on that Cranford does have that requirement.
Right, so three units would not comply and you have to meet the minimum. The board can't relieve you of that requirement for affordable units on this site.
Right, so we're looking at five. Could one be, but there is an existing residential on site. And if I remove that, that would change my number, wouldn't it? Because now I have one residential on site and I'm only adding 19 market rates.
No.
No?
Okay.
So I'll let her go.
Yeah,
but
we agree. No.
What I would like some flexibility so we can add affordable units to it if we have to and still keep the 20 market rate without increasing the building size. That's what I'm testifying.
So your request would be for 25 total units, and if you want 20 market rate units and you have to by law provide five affordables, that's a total of 25.
If that's what we have per the ordinance, then I would say yes.
This is for 23.
Yes.
Okay. And my other piggyback follow-up question, if the affordable units were the same as the market rate units, you wouldn't have this multi-user elevator issue, right?
Yeah, they wouldn't be stacked is what you're asking, correct?
Well, yeah, if all of the units were the same and just some of them were affordable, then you wouldn't have this market, this multi-user elevator issue. The multi-user elevator issue is only because the normal buildings have three floors for one person and the affordable buildings have three different families on three different levels,
but this
right?
is not something you've ordinance looks into. Your affordable units now are all in apartment buildings. These are not in an apartment building.
I'll rephrase my question. I'm asking, so you're saying difficult to provide elevators in the affordable units because you have a different user on each floor. Is that correct?
When you have
I think this is a very important issue, but I think Catherine Sarmat is better able to talk about this than Victor. Obviously, if it turns out that we have to rework it for the five units, so be it. But unless you want to, Catherine, you want to come
No, that's
up?
Fine. I just wanted to clarify.
It's a good point. It's just that I think it's more appropriate directed at our planner.
Okay.
I have two questions.
I'm going to be back up later. What I wanted to get our traffic engineer briefly, because she's a very busy woman. She's out every night. She's here just to show a comparison of this use compared to if it was remain industrial use. And then I can come back up. I would like to get... I'll come back up.
I do want to ask some questions.
Okay. Yeah, okay. I'm not inclined to do that just because people have questions based on what you just said,
and it gets
a little confusing.
Mr. Venegas, can you just speak to what is the use of the site now?
It was Real Strong Fuel, which had an oil heating service, HVAC, air conditioning, and plumbing services, and he did have also other truck storage on site.
And when did that end?
He sold the business a few months, maybe 9 months ago, 12 months ago.
And he operated as all the things that you said until that time?
Yeah. 50 years.
Okay. And I think it was longer than that. But when he ceased the operation of the site for, let's say, oil, was he required to do anything in terms of taking tanks out of the ground and removing various
things? Remove part of the sale contract is he has to remove all tanks.
What are the five tanks standing there now?
No, the underground tanks, sorry.
Oh, okay.
And he has to remove the oil, because by law, when you remove the underground tank, there's the ones you can see the leak underground. So you have contaminated soil. So he did remove, he had clean tank removals in the past. He showed me the certificates inspected by the construction department. He had one tank remaining. He removed that one tank and there was holes in it. Mm-hmm. Small holes did have some oil contamination in the pit. And he has an on-site cleanup going on now from that underground tank that was behind the stacked tanks that are there.
Yeah, I think, as Tom knows, when you cease your industrial use per ISRO, you have a cleanup obligation. and that is what he's in the process of. So it's an industrial use that has ceased, triggering extra requirement, and it's being cleaned and pursuant to Mr. Venegra's contract, it's being cleaned to a residential standard.
I'm asking residential standards.
But I, for example, if you have a service station, a gas service station, and you cease operating as such, you have an obligation to remove those underground tanks within, I think, a year. But are there, so there were there obligations that applied here for him to remove the various, or this business to remove these various tanks and facilities?
I don't know.
Mm-hmm. You usually enter into an agreement with the DEP as to what your plan is. Your LSRP puts together the plan and you abide by it. So, you know, certainly we can try and get that for you and get that schedule.
But he's not abandoning, if the approval doesn't happen and, you know, this doesn't go through, he's going to now remarket the piece what he owns, the garages and the tanks. So the tanks, I guess, are still valuable for people who want to, if you are a contractor and you buy bulk oil for your construction equipment, you don't have to buy taxed oil. So you can use those tanks to store bulk oil, which excavators do, landscapers do, very common, and they use undyed fuel for construction equipment.
Well, since we are talking about changing the use of this property to residential, it would be at the highest standard, right?
That's yes. What,
and it's hard for me to think about that today with information that we don't have. I mean, I drove by and I saw these five huge tanks, and I thought, yeah, this has been around for 100 years, and the history of these types of facilities are that they're, you know, there are in need of big remediation. That's just my hypothesis. I don't know the property itself, but it would behoove us, I think, to have some information that kind of confirms that you're doing these, you know, well, this cleanup, and that'll be done, and there won't be any problems later on for neighbors or...
Well, there is information. When you remove a tank, you have to get it inspected by the construction department. So there is a permit for removal of the tank.
Well, I'm actually talking about the property itself. I mean, you know, I know fuel oil. I remember these trucks, right. And the truck could have had a leak, right? The property could be contaminated as well. And I think it wouldn't you need to have some sense of a clean bill of health, particularly since this is a residential?
Well, absolutely. You're absolutely right, Dan. I mean, everything, this project doesn't get a shovel in the ground until it's clean to environmental residential standards. So, yeah. You're absolutely right. And as my understanding, Victor, in speaking with Peter, that it environmentally, they didn't really have that many serious problems. It was a little spillage from the oil tanks, there wasn't any, you know, PCBs or...
He has a separate LSRP that is hired by him, that I am reviewing his LSRPs, his professional engineer's report. It is on file with the state. All you have to go is on a state that your engineer can go on a state data miner site. It shows up on a state data miner site of a tank pull, and he has to require a letter of no further action. Besides that, I hired a separate environmental company, and I can supply that data, to do borings around the site. And we submitted those soil borings to a lab for analysis, for all, you know, looking for whatever kind of contamination, and they all came back negative, and I can supply that data.
It's not that I don't believe you.
Oh, no problem. No, it's on file. What's great about the state requiring local inspectors to come out there, construction officials were out there, licensed professionals were out there, they saw the oil in the ground, notified DEP instantly. Now it's on site, it's on the data miner site, you can get the levels. You can get all the information off of DEP, and now it's in the hands of DEP. It's not in the hands of municipality. It's not in the hands of me. I don't own the land. It's in the hand of the LSRP, the licensed professional, has to supply the state their couple months' worth of monitoring to show there's no contaminant in the groundwater.
And that's been done?
That's being done right now as we speak, yes.
So if you give us the benefit of the doubt, Dan, if and when we get to site plan, that's when we're going to prove it to you.
Okay. I'm not sure what I'd be looking at anyway, but from the map here, the access road, where does that come out onto Lexington?
There's a home
at
here.
At the top.
Okay, let me see if I can pull them. This is the last lot on Lexington right here. And then you come out to, what's the Colin?
Chester Lang.
Chester Lang is about here on the map.
No, Georgia.
Georgia's this way.
Yeah, so those backyards are Georgia that abut the access drive.
That is correct.
Right, so that'll be a new road. Right?
No, this
it's existing drive.
That existing now?
Yeah.
Okay, so the new exit is down halfway down there.
Here, right there. Correct. Okay. The existing driveway is down here.
So from Georgia, I imagine in one respect, taking out those five huge, I can't believe how big those tanks were. They were there
big.
Before the houses. I noticed on your photograph. I was trying to figure out whoever allowed that? But so those backyards are going to be looking, there's an existing drive there, but there's no landscaping.
There is, we will have landscaping. There will be solid fencing. We're going to have all those items.
Wouldn't that be on that? No, I guess on a
file. Well, we did give a full landscape plan.
There is
board fencing. Let me go into the site photos, maybe. Photos. Come on. I am not the best with this machine. Full screen. So this is a photo from the side yard of one of the folks along Georgia. I took this photo April 1st, so those are the tanks. And that's approximately where the buildings will be. This is now from the other side along the property line, looking from Georgia to the site. So those are those tanks we're talking about.
So they'll be gone.
They'll be removed, yes.
And what will you be looking at?
This is a site, this is a view from the tanks on the premises. This is one of the homes that exist along Georgia. So these are the tanks we're talking about. They'll have to be removed, obviously. And if there's any more spill material underneath these tanks, it'll have to be remediated. That's state law. This is a view from the site. Again, I took these photos. I climbed up on the tanks and have a picture of the old garage here, all the asphalt over here. Like I said, a large amount of impervious. This is now a look towards the west. This is the warehouse, the large earthen berm here. There was a hedgerow of trees there that had all been removed. So this area was buffered at one time. It's no longer. So this is the commercial uses out here. This is all asphalt and gravel. This is the old scale that you saw in that photograph that was over 100 years old. This is a view from Lexington, the old office, garages. There's a house over here.
Is that the driveway out?
Yep, that's the existing driveway out. So this was at one time, you can see the gouges in here. It was used by, at one time, I understand, large trucks that would bottom out in this driveway, the longer tractor trailer types. Again, this will be removed. So we had test borings throughout this site in the asphalt area. We cored it with a core drill, and then they did a punch test. They did the sample, sent it out for a lab for priority pollutants, and very surprised that they were all negative except for one, and the one was by the oil tanks where the one leaked. This is a view from the driveway. You can see the trees. There's some trees back in here. This is where the oil tanks back in here underground. These are mixed. We're going to replant again this whole area. And that's about it for the photos.
Want to call this site?
Oh, yeah.
Site pictures? I don't know what works. A6?
Yeah, existing photos on site that. Large icons. There we go. So I guess this is the photo I mean, why does that keep coming up? So.
They have that sheet, right?
Colorized sheet 3 would show the existing, and A5 would be colorized proposed. Were you just finished showing them?
I think so. Lexington rendering. Not that one. What I did also, which we normally don't do for projects of this size, but we hired an architect to do full architectural. So in your set, they're full architectural.
I thought that was A4, right? This is A4.
Is that existing?
That is proposed of your sheet.
A5. Can you go to A4?
What
was the existing?
What was A? Oh, the aerial view? No.
I didn't have an A5.
It was two. It was historical photos, overview of the site. Maybe architects, yeah.
View from Lexington.
Yeah. That's the one I just had right. So now you want A5?
Well, A5
would be the... A5 would be the photographs site.
I had that as A4.
That was A4.
I thought A4 was colorized sheet 3 of the existing site.
No, it was colorized sheet 3 of the proposed. It's similar to the sheet 3 in the set, or the architectural. I mean, the landscape architectural plans.
So, given the conversation about the affordable housing, should we be considering 25 units instead of 23?
Based on discussions with your planners and my planners, based on the municipal ordinance, because the state is 15% for rentals, but you're 20%, so it's an increased amount. So to meet your ordinance, we'd have to have 5 affordables.
Is that a yes?
Yeah, that's a yes. But that's why. That's why it was missing. It was the 3 weren't there because, again, we were going by 15%. But we can't go by 15% because your planner's telling us, no, it's 20%.
Do you want to drop the market value? Maybe drop that down a little bit? I said, do you want to drop down the market value units instead of going up in
affordable?
Well, there's
economics.
I get it. I'm just asking a question.
We're really not looking to go that route because, okay. Again, the purchase price of this property and the economics of doing all this cleanup.
So you're increasing the units overall then?
We're not increasing, yes, we're increasing the units overall, but not the footprints of the building.
Okay.
So the
Madam Chair, can we evaluate that without a site plan showing that?
Well, that's the thing. So how many do you show on your site plan?
Well, I'd like to continue with the traffic, and we're not going to get through the meeting tonight. I can have a new architectural layout for the next meeting.
Right.
Your layout show? 23?
Yeah.
It shows 3 now.
23 now.
It shows 20 market rate, three affordable units. So if we have to go to 5 affordable units, I'd like to, if that's the case, I'd like to submit a revised conceptual for the next meeting.
Is that going to affect your traffic?
And then we renotice it. Excuse me?
Is that going to affect your traffic witnesses?
Well, I'll let the traffic engineer decide that. 25 total. But the affordable units will only be most likely one to two bedroom. So you will be able to drive. So.
I have another question, sorry. Does it impact parking as well, which you testified to earlier?
We're still well over parked. So no matter what, we're going to be more than the ordinance requires and more than RSIS requires. The ratio is going to be less, but we're still going to be well overparked. And I don't think we should have much more parking. I mean, impervious coverage and more parking is something, you know.
Yeah,
we're well overparked right now. I think we're 20 spaces overparked.
I think we should hear from our planner with respect to this. I didn't realize you're showing 23 on your most recent. We had a discussion with this before, so maybe you can address the issue, the problem.
When the application came to DRC, I believe in September, there were 24 total units proposed. They were required to provide 6 affordable units. We did tell them of the requirement at that time. We issued a letter, I believe, in October or November, which also stated the requirement that was 20%, and they were required to provide 5 on-site, and they were deficient. Mm-hmm. And now in our last memo that we did update last week, we did update those numbers, and 5 are required for the 23, and that's in our memo. So I guess the short answer is the plans show 23 overall units. That was changed last week. There were 24 units previously, and then 3 are affordable per the plans.
And what's your position? You asked me, could we evaluate that? What's your position about whether we can evaluate
change? I think that what the applicant was asking for is not just the use of townhouses, but specifically 23 units. I mean, that was the ask. That was the opening statement. And, you know, the opening statement did call this an affordable housing, you know, project and an accessible project, and did use those terms, categorizing it like they were at least meeting the minimum requirements. But I think that's a mischaracterization if they're not meeting the state or our municipal minimum. So I would say if the applicant is going to revise the plans to show this, then they should take the time to address some of the other major comments of the reports and some of the questions addressed here. But maybe the board has enough information to give them the answer that they're seeking. Is the 23 units or 25 units, or I guess you asked for 23 units, and is 23 units an appropriate number of units on this site? That's the main question. And then how they split that up for market rate and affordable is per code. That's not really his choice.
Yeah.
So we can, you know, continue looking at that question and answering that question with this information.
Right. Can you evaluate this application for the use variance based upon a plan showing 23 units? That's a question for the board.
Well, I guess before we do that, if we said yes to 23, but you don't want that, right now you don't want that, then is that a waste of our time?
It's not that I don't want it. The application was always originally for more market rate units. We knocked it back to 20. It's for 20 market rate units, and whatever we have to satisfy for the affordable housing component.
Right, if you want 20 market rate units, then you have to do 25.
Now we have to go 25. But I was under the understanding that it was 15%.
I understand that, but we're not there anymore.
That's the state requirement.
Can we take a 5-minute break just to confer?
Yes, that sounds great. come back to order, please?
Yeah, so I've had discussions with the applicant, and we're going to stick with what the plan shows, 23 total units, five of which will be affordable rentals, staying within the same envelope, but reconfiguring the additional two rentals.
So the total unit count will be the same, but we're removing two market rate for sale units and adding two affordable rentals.
Okay.
I'd like to, again, I don't want to delve into affordable housing. It's not my expertise. I have my planner here. She wants to save me.
That's fine. I don't know if more board members have questions for this witness, but I understand Mr. Boyer has questions.
I actually just have one quick question. The access road is on whose property?
Excuse me?
That access road, whose property is on this property that we're discussing?
The access driveway?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's actually on this property, but he has an easement right.
Okay, there. That's what I was going to ask.
Can you just clarify where the setbacks are taken from? Where the impervious coverage calcs come in, where the density calculations come in, does that take into account that property that's not actually being used by the residential development?
No, because the driveway is owned by Real Strong Fuel. The property behind only has easement rights. So everything, all the impervious calculations comes off of the entire site.
But the density requirement calculations take into account that driveway, that piece of driveway that's not being used by the residential application that you're proposing, correct?
It, because it's owned by the occupant. It's owned by Real Strong Fuel, so you're allowed to include that area, yeah.
So if you were to subdivide out that driveway and give it to the back piece of property that's remaining?
We're not subdividing out that driveway.
What does that do to your impervious coverage calculations?
It does change it, but we're not subdividing out that driveway. Because it's an industrial use to a residential use, so you don't subdivide it out. It's going to be easemented.
Isn't it a residential use in the back?
Yes.
And your proposed use is residential?
That's correct.
So you're going to have a driveway going through a residential property to?
It's been an easement for since the site was constructed. That's correct.
Okay. Can you also just touch on, just because there's a lot on the site, what your plans are for trash removal? Is there a dumpster being proposed? Are trash cans going to be brought out?
At this time, we're looking to have city garbage come back up and pick up at this time. If they will not do it, then we would go to trash, private trash pickup. But now I don't like dumpsters. I'd rather have the private trash pickup with cans to the front of the unit. So if the town doesn't pick up, we'll have a private carter pick up the cans.
Sorry, what is town pickup? There is no town pickup in Cranford.
Oh, that's right. I have my, yeah. It will be a private carter.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Like right now, my cans are picked up. Sorry. My office.
I wanted to know. I don't have town pickup in my house. So I was trying to see how I can get them.
Me
get
too.
That.
I know. So it'll be right. It would be private trash. So just like your home is, they'll back up down the driveway. You put your cans in front of your unit, they'll pick up.
And regarding trash pickup, deliveries, things like that of that nature, I know you showed one of your pervious paver parking spaces or pervious areas as a backup area for fire trucks. Your plan shows a vehicle park there. Are those being taken into account for parking, or is that?
No, there's two. There's one space for a vehicle to park and one to back in. So I recounted the unit counts, and taking one out for the turnaround, there's 83 spaces shown, including there were surface 50 spaces, 33 exterior spaces. That's 83, taking out one for the turnout, it's 82 spaces. What's required is 53. So we're almost 20 spaces over, we're more than 20 spaces over.
Okay, so that I guess space on the left side would be striped or signed, say no parking, turnaround space only.
Yeah.
And can you just touch on building equipment like HVAC and the elevators? Is there anything mounted on the roofs?
No, the elevators are all internal. They're electric driven. HVAC is your typical rear air conditioner compressor on the back of the building.
Okay, so you would propose them on the back, adjacent to the driveway, back. Adjacent to the railroad tracks?
No, they'll be all rear mounted units.
Okay, but I'm referencing the driveway that's accessing the single family residential in the back.
Yeah, so it'll be typical AC unit, air conditioning compressor.
Okay. That's all I have.
Just a quick follow-up question regarding the elevators. Can you address how the maintenance and repair of the elevators will happen? You have all those private elevators. Are those with the condo association, or are those individual unit responsibility?
They're individual unit. The elevators company give you a five-year guarantee, and after that, it's with the individual homeowner.
Yeah, because for some of the residents that you're proposing, maybe their only entryway access if they're disabled into the building, you know, is there any plan to for another way of access if those get, if they break or need repair?
The first floor, the way we design these other units, the first floor is all ADA accessibility. It's a full bath on the first floor with ADA accessible bathroom. So in case something, say something happens, the person can stay on the first floor.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions from the board before I move to the public? Okay. I'll open up to the public. If you have a question for this witness, you can approach the podium at this point. You can just go ahead and come on up. If you can give us your name and your address.
Hi, Allison Menner, 230 North Avenue West, Cranford, New Jersey. Yeah.
Sorry to interrupt. Can we give her a little space at the dais? Is that okay?
Huh?
Just a little space, I think, at the dais. Mr. Vinagre?
Yeah, can he move back?
Would you mind just giving her a little space?
Thank you.
I just wanted to see her. Thank you.
So I could ask a question of Mr. Goodman?
Well, it's really for this witness.
Oh, okay. Well, Mr. Goodman speculated that Real Strong might sell to a business that has trucks coming and going. I mean, totally speculation. But are you aware that the township, the TC, recently passed an ordinance banning trucks on Lexington?
Is the witness aware?
Yeah, we are familiar. And we understand that this particular site was litigated by Judge Bell, and that trucks are permitted historical use, pre-existing nonconformity.
You're saying they're permitted?
They're pre-existing nonconformity truck route. I don't have the case number. I went down here to look at it. Because it's a historical facility for industrial, they're grandfathered in.
This facility, is that what you're saying? This facility is grandfathered
in? Yes, only
in?
This facility, yes.
But if it were to change to a different facility, that wouldn't be grandfathered in, would it?
If it was to change and become obviously residential, then that obviously this would all go away.
Right, but even if it were to change to a different use?
He's suggesting if the use remains the same.
As being a zoning officer and a planner, the uses stay with the property.
Mr. Goodman, could you be so kind as to get that to me, that decision?
Yeah, we'll try and get that decision, yes.
Thank you.
Sorry, just one question. Is that accurate, though? Does the use stay with the property? I thought the use stayed with whatever the use you were doing today. Because just thinking of other applications.
The use hasn't been abandoned. If another oil company wanted to come in here and it be an HVAC oil company, they could.
Right, but if another company came in and wanted to bring trucks in that wasn't an oil company or HVAC, they couldn't, correct?
Probably question the zoning officer.
Yeah, generally, go ahead.
So the use, it may change ownership, but the use may not expand or change that would impact the intent of it. So if a new user came in and required more trucks, longer hours, more intensity, right, they would have to come back before this board. If there's an intent to abandon, selling the business, removing the tanks, it could be argued that the use is being abandoned, so no continuation of this use could happen. I believe that's taking place on the site right now. I think that's the testimony we heard about 20 minutes ago, is that tanks had started to have been removed. So, I mean, there might be a case for abandonment of use already, but I mean, that might be for a later point. But I think that the simple question, I guess, to answer, but the neighbor was, could more trucks come? If the same amount stays for the same business, that would be permitted and protected. But once that use is abandoned or changed, it has to come back to this board for new use variance approval.
And I would respectfully disagree that when tanks are taken out, and most gas stations always take out the tanks when they change their brand, new gas stations come and put new tanks in. So it's the obligation of an existing owner of underground tank to remediate, and they always take out the tanks. If a new user comes in, be it an oil company or whatever, and they wanted to put in new tanks, I would maintain that the use hasn't been abandoned, that they could do it.
Did you have another question?
Mm-hmm. And Mr. Vinegra, you said that you had excellent luck in Garwood building a similar townhouse development. Just for the record, can you state what your professional positions that you hold within the township of Garwood?
The township of Garwood had excellent luck because the point is, like I stated, 44 townhouse units. And that's behind the old Rosie's Wine Bar. And I'm the planner and helped design that project. And that's where we had excellent luck. Yeah.
Right. For the record, can you state what professional positions you hold in the township of Garwood?
I'm the town planner and board engineer.
And also the zoning officer?
Yes, also zoning officer.
Okay. So am I right? This is in the R1 zone?
Yes.
So what would you be able to build if you just built within the guidelines of what's allowed according to the master plan and 2019 reexamination report of the master plan?
We did a layout. It was approximately two homes.
Why not just build that?
It's up to the previous owner, and this is an affordable housing project that has affordable housing component. This is an affordable housing project. This project is not two homes. It's for a townhouse project for age restricted, and I gave the reasoning for that.
Sorry, can I ask one question just to fall under that? Just Mr. Jardine, are you aware? Do you know if we are under our affordable housing requirements for Cranford right now, as of now?
No, I defer to Mr. Drill on that, but I believe we're in compliance.
We're in compliance.
Okay. The current round, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Certain.
And in 2013, there was a vacant land capacity analysis done by Harbor Consultants. Do you remember that?
For what municipality?
For Cranford.
Yeah, I did not work on that.
Okay.
I have a planner here who can testify to that.
Okay, I apologize. This isn't my field of expertise, but there was an RDP calculation, real estate development potential calculation in that 2000 VLC, and this parcel of land was not included in that as potential land to put townhouses.
Is that a question?
No, I don't know how to put it in the form of a question.
Sorry, you're not allowed to make statements at this time or give testimony. You just have to be allowed to ask questions.
All right. Well, I'll leave it at that for now. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Are there other members of the public who have questions? Come on up.
Hi, I'm Peter Haupt from 4 Aberdeen Court, and I'm somewhat of a layman, but I do have experience with a nephew who's in a wheelchair, and if I put somebody on third floor of a townhouse and there's a power failure or an elevator failure, is there a second means of egress or fire? And how does that work? And maybe you can explain that to me, because I can't see where it would be, ADA approved to be three stories without a second means of egress. Thank you.
Just give me your name one more time and your address.
Peter Haupt, Haupt. For Aberdeen Court.
Thank you.
There, by fire code, there has to be a second form of ingress and egress. There will be those stairs, and the units are designed so if the elevator's on the third floor and you enter it, and it has a backup battery that's good for a certain amount of time, but per code, if you get into it, it defaults and it goes to the first floor and opens and stays open.
Is that the same answer for the affordable?
Right now, the affordable we're talking about do not have elevators.
No,
do they have two means of egress?
Yes, they have to by fire code. It's going to meet fire code. The building will meet fire code.
The affordable housing units, they're going to be multiple stories, correct?
Yes.
And then they're not going to have elevators. And so if somebody's in a wheelchair in the affordable units, they can only access the first floor. Is that correct?
Right. So what my thought process is that if we do the affordables, the first floor will be ADA adaptable, yes.
Right. So the expectation is somebody in a wheelchair is in an affordable unit, and they're purchasing a multi-unit or renting a multi-unit facility. They're only going to access the first floor. That's your expectation.
Yes. Yes.
And Ms. Sarmad will speak to your issue.
I know she's going to speak to the affordable housing, but we're speaking to the actual like design of the units.
Actually, I have a follow-up to that.
Go ahead.
So my understanding, and if you can clarify, the affordable units are not multi-floor. They're only one floor.
They will be multi-floor.
The affordable units?
They're going to be stacked.
No, but one unit won't have more than one floor.
Okay. But I think it's... Correct. Yeah, there could be three affordable units.
Yeah. I just want to clarify that.
Yeah. Well, how does that work then? So if you're going to have three affordable units stacked... So then two of the three affordable units, you can't have somebody with a wheelchair in them?
Correct.
Okay.
There are other questions from members of the public? Come on up.
Here you go, Rita.
Oh, thank you.
Maybe have her on the mic.
Okay. Rita Labruda, 104 Arlington Road. So the first question that I had was, you said that you were overparked, but then I was looking in the, I think it was the planner's report and the key, and you said there were 82, 53 required, but I thought what I saw in there were 34 market rate and 10 for affordable housing. So that would only be 44. So I'm looking at this. It's on the key.
It's shown on the cover page, Rita, of my plans that per RSIS, we required 53 spaces, and there's 82 proposed.
Right, but do you see on topology's report, page 12 of 16, they have listed here that it's required 53 spaces, but they're saying proposed are...
82. There's a letter.
It's 82, but then they have 34 and 10. So where are the other...
She's breaking out the market rate spaces.
34 for market rate and 10 spaces for affordable.
Right. It's a total of 82 spaces.
I get that, but I don't see how the breakout adds up. Do you? I mean, can the planner answer that? I don't know whose document that is.
The sheet 3.
Go ahead.
So it's the combination of inside the driveway, outside the driveway, and then the surface spaces. So the only math that doesn't math there is that all of the units have a garage parking space, and then you can park in front of the garage spaces.
So it's tandem.
Except for the affordables, which have no garage spaces.
Okay, so you're able to count the space in the garage and the one in the...
Correct.
Driveway.
Yep, where like the nose of your car would touch your garage door if it were closed.
Right.
Okay.
Gotcha. Okay, so then, all right, I get
that. Ms. Petros, can you clarify, why does it say on your report compliance must be confirmed?
Well, so for RSIS, the calculation includes guest parking. and spaces for the residents, but the way that this site is designed doesn't differentiate that or provide enough, because there's like a combined parking lot for that looks kind of like it's for guests or overflow, but since the affordable units aren't provided garages, then those technically should be the affordable spaces and not guest parking, and then there's a deficiency in guest parking. So because they haven't really accounted for that or like matched them appropriately, we're not really sure how they're doing it. So I can't provide the exact compliance metric for that. And then the rest of the compliance could be confirmed as the EV.
So that was going to be my second question, is where was the visitor parking? So they would basically have to park in the person's driveway?
Some do. And as I testified, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 overflow visitors parking spaces on site. There's okay. Three units for the affordable.
Yep.
And there's 2 per in these driveways.
Mm-hmm.
And if you have a visitor, they can park either in your driveway or one of these overflow spaces.
Okay. Let's see. Can you mentioned the units. There are 9 units, I think it was, at 484 4th Avenue. And that site is, looks like 1.024 acres with 9 units. This site is 1.7 acres, am I correct?
That site is over 1/3 wetlands and woodlands. So that can't be developed.
Right. Okay, but this site is 1.7 acres and 23 units?
It's a 14 unit an acre density.
It's 14 units per...
It's like 13.9 units per acre density.
12.9 on the key again.
Yeah.
Right, okay. But the density required is 3.36, right? So is this 4 times... more dense than what is required?
I didn't testify. I'm going to let my planner testify into the density variance.
Okay. So I guess the one question, and I was kind of pleased to see that there wasn't a lot of contamination on this site. It looked like there was a small oil spillage. So then the question becomes is, so then why do you need so many units? Because usually when people want a lot of units, it's because there's a lot of high cost in cleaning up a contaminated site.
There's still a good deal of cleanup that has to occur on the site. It is asphalt removal, demo of the building, demo of the tanks. There's some expenses on the site.
Yeah, cost of doing business.
Yep.
Okay, so impervious surface, I know it was like 70-something. So now you have it down to 51%, but the town ordinance is 35%. So are you proposing stormwater catch basins and things like that? And then with those stormwater basins, what then would... Is the 51% the impervious coverage with the stormwater basin?
Yes. What happens is, right now, according to our plans, the impervious coverage is about 67%, including the crushed.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going down to 52%, so there's a reduction. The requirement for 35% is for single-family homes. This is not single-family home. So that's why the variance is requested, because this is a townhouse development.
And do you know what it would be for, like, I think this would have, if it was zoned for townhouse, it would be about 15 versus 23. Isn't that correct?
Impervious coverage? No, it would be something very similar. If you're going to get 14 units an acre to get your parking counts to work, this is that's probably the most efficient layout you could get without additional asphalt. So I can't see the impervious coverage ever being less than this, because we needed a turnaround for fire trucks, we needed a backup area, and some additional overflow parking. And anytime I had overflow parking, we had permeable pavers.
Right, but if you had less units, your impervious coverage would go down.
Yes, that's, yes. But right? This application isn't for that, correct?
Okay.
Can I just follow up on that? I don't think you answered the question. If this was zoned for townhouses, what would be the allowable impervious coverage?
If normally in a townhouse zone, and when we write an ordinance for townhouse zone, the norm is somewhere around 14 units an acre. That's what we write townhouse zone.
That's density. I'm talking about impervious coverage.
Oh, impervious coverage. It would be a little bit more than what I'm seeking because, again, it's an efficient layout, and sometimes you don't always get the additional layout. But this impervious coverage amount is low because it's a very efficient layout.
Okay. But so do you not know the answer to my question?
Okay. So the planner just whispered in my ear, so it was the
answer. You know, if it's not coming from you, we'll just get it from her.
Yeah,
thanks.
Yeah. Let's get her up.
Okay. You also mentioned Garwood Point. That's the development on South Avenue, right?
No, that's North Avenue.
North Avenue, I'm sorry. So that's a state highway, right? So would you say that's a little different than that?
Those units actually back up to residential neighborhood in Westfield.
They do, yes. But they front.
No, they do not front. They front on a side street on Westfield.
Oh, they front on that street that goes to the ShopRite, right?
Yes, that goes off the ShopRite by the playgrounds. But they abut a residential zone, and they're not fronted on a state highway.
Okay. I think... Now, you said the affordable housing units were going to be rentals?
We're looking for rentals, yes.
And I guess the planner will... In round four, there are no more rental bonus credits for rentals, correct?
I'll let my affordable housing planner answer that question.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you. The other members of the public, come on up.
Good evening. Peter Potenciano, 9 Georgia Street. Okay, so I have a couple of questions. You guys touched on a lot of points.
Can you speak into the microphone?
So, Potenciano, Potenciano.
Hey, Pete, if you need to put down your paper, maybe you could swap spots and use the microphone.
Okay. That'd be
easier.
So, again, you guys touched on a lot of points. I'll try to keep my questions a little limited. But so right now, we're all looking to put in 23 dwellings in this on this, 1.8-acre property.
Yes.
Correct? All right, so with that... And we're going with 55 and over, right?
That's correct.
So the question is it going to be 55 on the deed when you sell these properties, or is it going to be 55 to live in? That's my first question.
It's regulated by federal requirement. It's on the deed.
So it's like going in a bar, right? And I'm 21 to drink, but I can be 18 to enter. So basically, I could have an 18-year-old living in one of those properties.
You can't have the federal requirement, no one below the age of 17 is allowed to occupy.
So okay.
Full time.
So this is 55 on the deed, is what you're saying.
Yeah.
All right. So with that said, then.
And there's a homeowners association, and there's also bylaws that have to be generated and filed with the county or union, and the bylaws have to follow the federal requirements.
Okay. So the HOA is going to govern.
Yes.
And monitor all that.
Yes.
So I guess the question is quality of life changes, right? With the type of people, you know, not discriminating against age, just the type of people, like right if. I could buy this property with my mother's name, have my kids live in it.
The HOA normally regulates that. There has to be, it's a federal law, there has to be someone 55 and older living in the structure.
Okay.
And there can't be anybody, school-aged children, 17 and younger, living in the structure.
Well, I'm talking about people in their 20s nowadays where they can't afford living in the city or something.
Well, the deed restricted, so you have to be on the deed. You have to, the purchaser has to have it, and that's why you have a homeowners association.
Okay, all right, so then I guess
they're built all over. I mean, we haven't had any.
Oh, no, issue. I know, I've seen them, and that's the reason I asked the question. So I guess with that in mind, you showed four properties. I don't know how you're going to readjust the conceptual, but you show four properties with balconies facing the neighbors on Georgia Street. Now, obviously, I'm basically one of those houses within the line of sight of those balconies, right?
Yeah, we talked yesterday, yeah.
Right, right. So is there, you're going to be putting Juliet balconies on the other ones. Can you change that concept to just put Juliet balconies all on the houses facing the neighbors?
I think that's something that's reasonable, yeah.
All right, because that's, last thing, look, as we get older, you know, inhibitions change. You don't want to be drinking a smoking a stogie, drinking a beer, and hanging out in your birthday suit outside.
That's why, like I said,
All right.
I rang his doorbell yesterday. We were talking about this yesterday.
You know, I got kids. I got little kids. Yeah. The last thing I need to see is somebody in my line of sight. And
yeah, we talked. I stopped by yesterday. I rang all the doorbells, and this
all
is.
All right, so that's something kind of addressing some of the quality of the tenants that you're going to be having in there.
Yep.
Right,
yep. But I think along that end, Juliet balconies would be fine. You get the air movement. You get the natural light coming in. Maybe you can just have enough in the Juliet for plants.
Okay.
That'd be fine.
Okay, that's number two. So then I guess the other one was touching on the topography of this piece of lot, right? I live in George Street. I know that lot is a lot higher than my backyard. I mean, based on that, you talked about putting berms and fences. I mean, what was your elevation grade when
this site's going to drain to inlets and go into water quality basins.
Pitching towards the tracks?
Yes, yes. So these roof leaders would tie into a roof leader collection system, into a detention basin underneath the parking lot, and into these water quality basins.
So it's pitching west, but you got neighbors to the south, right?
It's all going to be self-contained, more or less. This drain is going to be self-contained, more or less. Your site's actually, it's a little, but we have the deviso of that driveway, of Mike's driveway.
Which is going to be another question later on, because I don't think you got to it yet, but because the question on that is going to be the width of that driveway, if you're utilizing that for some of your
No. Right now, the site in the back has, in the deed, the ability to use that driveway. That would be given up. That would be given back.
I think it's a little light on the width.
That would be given back to Mike. So this would now give away that right to use Mike's driveway. So now they're going to give up that right because they have access to Lexington Avenue.
Okay. All right, so then I guess my Lexington Avenue. So you're going to increase traffic. All right, I guess we'll get to that point later on. But then, again, with the new era on trying to reduce greenhouse gases, right, by 2035, it's supposed to try to remove all that, you know, fossil fuel. When people start moving in here, all the appliances you're putting in there are all going to be electric?
So far, we're doing mostly electric on some of the kitchen appliances. Still, some of the heating is natural gas.
All right, because then
it's not oil.
Nah.
All the fuel you want, but it's not oil.
Well, then I guess with that said, then if you're going to split your utilities, you're going to say half of it's gas and half is electric?
Well, we did the last one. People still, it's still a benefit, I think, to have natural gas heat.
Because the issues we have on this street, and even though we've made it a little bit more robust, is that transformer that's, I think, Vortis Clark, it takes a hit once in a while because it gets overloaded. So if you really go all electric in there, you're going to put more of a load on our electrical infrastructure that runs up for our neighbors.
Yeah, I'm not looking to go all electric, looking to do something.
Well, the problem is, too, is you can't monitor people when they start buying EVs and plugging into, you're probably going to run 277. So that draws a lot of power from the electrical load.
I have an EV. I charge at home at night. All you have to do is a 20-amp dryer plug in the garage. Every EV comes with its own charger. There's a lot of misconceptions about them. I've had it for 3 years. I charge at home. It's no more electricity than a dryer.
All right. Well, you can guarantee we're not going to be flipping the street all the time.
But what happens is you'll put a EV adaptable plug in the garage next to the panel, and it's just a 20 to 30 amp plug, 208. So we do it. It's standard now, so people can have an EV in the garage.
All right. Well, I guess my last question is, a while back you touched on what was you doing the cleanup.
Right.
This was number two. Heating fuel, right?
Yeah.
Ever have a number six?
I don't know. I have to take a look.
And that's a lot more. Well, you know, that's going to be a lot more.
We were talking yesterday about all this. Right. When we get the final report from their environmental engineer, we're going to put it on file with the town.
Okay.
So, It's an ongoing, this site's an ongoing site.
If there was number six on that site at one time, that is a lot of contaminants. Yeah. And that
just going to ask you limit to questions right now, sorry.
Okay.
Thank you, Victor.
Okay.
Thanks. Any other questions from the public? Go ahead.
My name is Donald Leonard, and I, excuse me, living at 525 Lexington Avenue.
I'm sorry, can you give me your name one more time?
Donna Leonard. I'm a block away from where they want to put up these units. My question is regarding the traffic. Right now, Lexington Avenue is extremely heavily trafficked. It backs up from Walnut Avenue down Chester Lane.
I think I'm just going to stop you here because they do have a traffic expert, and that person has not testified yet. So it would be more appropriate to ask a question about traffic to the traffic expert when that person testifies.
Okay, and that'll be at the next meeting?
Well, that's up to the applicant, but.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. So I'll defer until.
Thank
next.
You.
Okay.
Tara Temple, 54 Tara, T-A-R-A, Temple, T-E-M-P-L-E, 542 Lexington Ave. I guess my question would be, it kind of seems like you're trying to add the affordable housing to be a little bit palatable for the board and everything. If we meet the requirements that Cranford already has for affordable housing, why do we need to add that now? Is there a reason you just don't go for selling all the townhomes and keeping it even less than 23?
There's another round of affordable housing coming out, but they do have an ordinance, but I'll let my affordable housing expert, who told me don't answer any more questions when it comes to affordable housing, she will answer that question.
Okay.
Can I ask a question of yourself? I know you have an expert coming, but have you worked with the town for the next round of affordable housing that's come up?
Yeah, my expert, it does all that.
I know, I'm asking you because you spoke to affordable housing earlier and you're the owner of the application.
We're preparing for this next round when the numbers come out.
Right, so have you worked with the town though? Have you gone to the town and had the conversation about affordable housing? And
on this project?
On this project.
No.
No, so you've not had any contact with the town about the next round of affordable housing?
We had contact at the conceptual. We have the ordinance that says 20% set aside.
Right, today. You just learned there was 20%. But I'm saying you've had no conversations with the town about being a part of that next round of affordable housing.
No.
Okay. Just wanted to ask.
Any other questions from the public?
Hello. Brian Huter, 19 Chester Lang Place. So I live pretty around the corner from the site. Yeah. So it seems like a pretty massive undertaking building 23 units. How will that affect neighbors during the construction period, and how will you mitigate that and hopefully make it better than what's going on at 750 Walnut currently?
Well, these aren't your normal type of units in that there's not a mass market. This isn't like a big apartment building like that, you know, they're popping up all over not just Cranford, everywhere. They're most likely to be, I would say, be built in phases. So normally you would build the front phases first, have the equipment in the rear, and as you build, you build back. So again, you frame out, maybe you build these two, frame them out, get temporary COs on this, then build these two, and then build the last one. Because again, this is a limited market. It's not a large apartment building that gets all built at once. It's normally built in phases.
So I guess how long would you envision that taking? And you mentioned removal of some like asphalt that's been compacted for 100 years. Like how invasive?
That normally happens in the beginning. The demolition is done all at once. Normally you want to get rid of the demolition all at once. And then you want to phase construction because then again, you are looking at a limited market. Again, they have to be 55 and older. They have to qualify. They have to go to a homeowners association. And so this will probably be a two-year build-out at least.
So that seems pretty, it would be disruptive, I guess.
Well, there's a wood frame. It's no bigger. It's no different than building a single-family home, just a little bit longer. Okay. It's still wood frame construction.
So just 23 instead of two, yeah. I suppose. Yeah. But okay.
So we're doing those now. In the other project, we built the first five. They sold. Now we're going to build the next four. So, and then you put a safety fence up, you put a buffer up, you landscape it, and you, you it's very common to do this, this type of project in phases.
Thank you.
Toby Singbaba, 131 Mohawk Drive. So you said you that this was an affordable housing development, correct?
It has a component, yes.
Can you talk to your experience with specifically 55 and older affordable housing developments?
Well, right, not affordable housing. Again, there'll be a percentage of the units that will be affordable on this. But they're going to be, we're looking at, I think it was 18 now, market rate townhouse units.
I'm talking about your previous experience with 55 plus affordable housing developments.
We've done apartment complexes that are 100% 55 affordable, yes.
And have any of those had this dynamic with ownership and rental, where
no.
the owners would have to be responsible for the tenants leasing?
No, it's risky. It's risky.
Have you contemplated some of the risks that could come from
yes.
55 and older?
Yes.
And can you tell the board and the audience what those risks would be?
I already told her. I already told her. I think it should be a rental property because the risk is if the homeowners association is a burden with if it's a for sale product and there's a default on the mortgage, then the homeowners association has to eat that. If it's rental, they can eat the one rental. So that's a business decision. It's something that we have to work into that. My previous experience is 100% affordable projects in multiple municipalities with companies like CIS, Westfield Senior Housing. Westfield Senior Housing is very interested in the site. Westfield Senior Housing would be very interested, but not this product. They build rental-only apartment buildings for seniors. So I know I've done work for Westfield Senior Housing, but I said it's not... I don't think this is the right site for that type of use.
The affordable housing will have their own designated parking spaces specifically
yes.
to each
yes.
unit?
Yes.
And so the visitors would have to be parking where?
Well, you know, we show here in a site plan that the affordable right now have three spaces for the occupants. And the visitors could park here, here, or here.
And so each of those spots would be one designated for each individual unit?
They're visitor spaces. The visitor spaces are generally, you don't designate visitor spaces. They're for visitors.
So I guess, I mean, the first three.
Yeah,
so one would be for unit three, the next
yep.
for four, the next one for five.
Yes.
And so if that 55 and older came back and one of the visitors, someone had taken their spot, they would have to park over on those pavers where you said
yeah.
were not good for... high heel shoes.
Yes. And so, but hopefully, you know, those signs are going to be reserved parking spaces. It's no different than someone parks in front of your house in your driveway. That's going to be reserved for the occupant of that unit.
Except if there was a clear designated visitor parking on stable concrete and not the pavers would have falling risk, then it wouldn't.
It's not
have
a
that.
Falling risk. That's a misconception. I said, because I use these already, I wouldn't install them at my own office if they were a falling risk. I said they're soft and not great on women's heels.
Okay. Can you talk more about why you removed the decks on building one?
I testified before to so that was in discussion with the, if you were within 200 feet, you would have gotten notice of our meeting. That was a concern that came up from the resident along that area.
Did you receive any similar feedback regarding buildings two or building three?
Well, we just had feedback just now. You yeah. just heard it. And I really don't have an issue with that as long as they have a small balcony there for plants. Again, you know, we're here for a bigger picture. You know, we're getting into plant sizes and deck sizes. What I'm really here is a bifurcated application to see if this municipality, this board, would welcome this type of development. And this other finite minutia could be handled at site plan phase. Really, we want to look at the bigger picture here. I mean, I can come back in with more detailed architecture. I can come back in
with a planting plan that's more detailed. But right now, we want to see if the board would welcome something of this nature. That's what we're here for.
So then you would be open to considering removing all the balconies entirely?
I didn't say that, no. But again, well, I think the balcony discussion now, I'd like to stop it at these units here and keep these units here and these units along there.
So then are you saying that you did not hear feedback consistent with building one?
Yes, that's what I said. I stated to you before, the only feedback I heard at our meetings was a removal of the balconies here.
Okay. So if you received additional feedback from the other residents around building two and building three that had similar feedback, would you take that into account?
Well, I already said provision? I would take that into account in this building, but no one, I talked to Mr. Marcus, he doesn't have a problem with these.
Okay.
So he doesn't, I already had discussions with that owner.
And I couldn't see it. When you talked about the turnaround for fire trucks, was that taken into account, the paver parking spaces?
Yes, they're allowed for, in fact, pavers are commonly used for emergency vehicle access.
And so what would that do to prevent, if there were cars parked there, what kind of delay would that cause for the fire department to react?
It's going to be labeled fire zone, no parking.
Are you aware that the area is designed to have ease of walking for children to the local elementary schools, including paths? So for example, there are children living on Lexington that walk to school. Where of that in the neighborhood?
We're at the end of a dead end.
Right, I'm saying so from here on up. So if you're walking here and you're walking up towards Walnut.
So there's two houses, actually three, that face Lexington across from us. Okay. So those are the only three, and they're the end.
Okay.
And we're on the other end there on our side, so.
And the nearest intersection to there, Chester Lang, Lexington, and Georgia, you're aware that's an off-centered?
Yes.
Type of intersection?
Yep.
And you're aware that there it has a propensity for accidents?
I don't know if a propensity for accidents. I didn't get a police report for a propensity for accidents.
Okay. I'm sorry, anecdotally, I see that quite often there. And
I drive that road daily, and I don't witness. Just, I drive that road daily. Yeah. I live on the other end of Lexington. Just for your knowledge, and I've lived there for over 20 years.
So
would, I take Lexington.
Are you taking into account the number of additional drivers, including 55 and plus, that now would be navigating that off-centered intersection?
We have a traffic engineer that's going to go into trip generation for this layout versus the existing use.
Okay. I think that's all for now. Thank you.
Okay. We have other testimony going to come up. So.
Thank you. Any other questions from the public?
Lauren O'Brien, 214 Oak Lane. So I grew up on Lexington. My mom still lives there. And when we moved in, there was no flooding in our backyard. And the other day with all the rain, she sent me a picture of the backyard, completely flooded. It was almost like a small lake. And the only thing that's really changed is the building on 750 Walnut. So you could see that from your pictures, 750 Walnut. And that isn't even being finished being built. So adding this on top of that, and you just putting in, I think, two water basins, adding all this structure where there's only a small house, a small little office building and some other little structure.
There's a sea of asphalt out there. A sea of asphalt.
But you said there is gravel.
It's gravel, but right? It's combined gravel. It's going to be tested. We're going to give the engineer.
Let me just interrupt for a second. What's the question?
About the water, about what are we going to do about flooding? I mean, you're already flooding. They're already flooding now.
Thank you.
And adding.
Not only will my belief is the impervious coverage will be reduced. There's going to be a litany of items placed in there, water quality basins and detention basins. So the site's going to be much better as far as stormwater than it exists today. And this is a high, the only advantage this site too, it mostly drains towards the railroad, but now it's gonna have detention basins and water quality basins. And you know, we're gonna work it out. It's the one site that we normally don't get the beauty that we can actually reduce some of the hard coverages out there.
Thank you. Any other questions from the public? Any other questions from the board? Okay. Looks like we're finished with this witness.
Bessie Dolan?
Well, I'm sorry, but it's already 10:41.
Pardon?
It's already 10:41. We don't take new testimony after 10:30, so we're going to have to go to the next date. I'm sorry, what date is that? May 20th? 20? Does that work for the applicant? Thank you.
Just want to address one notice issue, please.
Okay.
May 20?
Mr. Goodman, could you just address one issue with respect to notice in anticipation for the next time? You had mentioned easements. Is there any part of this property that has granted an easement to anybody else adjoining?
Victor, there is an existing easement that is granted to the house behind, correct?
Yes.
Yeah, that's the only easement I know.
Okay, you need to keep in mind that if any part of this property has granted an easement to another property, your notice is required to include 200 feet from that property as well, right?
Okay, yes.
Okay, so I'm not sure that was done this time, so.
The easement is entirely contained on the Real Strong Fuel property, and the 200-foot adjoining owner's list went from the property line out. So it would include, yes.
From that property, you went 200 feet. Okay, and the railroad property as well, or any easements on that side? I imagine there would be.
No, there's not.
No?
The electric lines and gas lines are within the railroad right-of-way.
Okay.
It's within the railroad. It's a railroad easement. We did a title search and survey of the Real Strong property.
Thank you. Ms. Chair, can I just ask a question of yourself? Can we just confirm, so when we come back on May 20th, it's going to be a total of 23 units? We're not going to increase that?
Yeah, so we're going to go with the total 23 units, 5 affordable.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, so the next meeting on this application will be May 20th. The workshop will start at 7:30 and the public portion will start at 7:45.
Thank you.
Thank you. Now's a portion of the meeting if you want to make a comment, not about this application nor about any other application. Now would be your opportunity to do so.
This is public comment?
Public comment, yes. If I can just have a quiet, we're not done with the meeting. You're free to leave, but if we could just have some quiet, please. Can you just come to order? If you're still in the room, can you just remain quiet? Thank you.
So I would just like to address the board as far as the approval.
Name and address, please.
Rita Labruto, 104 Arlington Road.
Thank you.
This board approved the mikveh before you saw the lease for the parking. I personally negligent.
I'm going to stop you for just a moment, okay?
Why? It's public comments.
Can you just wait just a moment, please?
I can wait.
Go ahead.
So this board approved the mikveh before you even saw the lease for the parking. So I, for one, did not understand that for the life of me, because there was a parking problem there, okay? And there is more, even more than a parking problem, there's going to be a drop-off problem. So when you grant a variance, it is in perpetuity. How long is the lease for? Is it going to match in perpetuity as long as this variance is granted? Did anyone even consider that if this lease goes away, now you have a mikveh without parking?
I'm going to address that since you're asking a question, but I think the issue did come up and there was a response to that. That while the lease goes to 2033, I think.
Nobody has seen it, right?
We did see
it. We've all seen
it. Tonight, the public has not seen the lease.
No, it's not something that the public would be
required
to see.
Well, I'm putting an Oprah in for it, but anyway.
That's fine, but it's not something that is not part of that.
It should have been, my point is, it should have been addressed that night as part of the application before an approval. And I just think that was negligent on your part and on the attorney's part to even allow you to have done something like that. So, okay, so, I mean, it's public comments. You may not like it, but I have the right to my opinion. That's just kind of how it works in a democracy. So it is, you know, I'm not, just my opinion. Don't take it personal.
Thank you for your opinion.
The other thing I would like to mention is on 100 Lambert. You decided not to take that. There is case law that says you should have taken an interpretation.
We have not made a decision on that,
okay.
And therefore I'm going to stop you right now.
Okay.
I'm going to stop you because
okay.
It may be in front of the board, and that's not what this time is for.
Okay.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay. Then I'll entertain a motion for adjournment.
I'm happy to make a motion to adjourn the proceedings this evening.
I'll second it.
Do you want to know when the next meeting?
No.
Thank you, yes.
April 29th.
April 29th, thank you. Anybody opposed to adjourning? No. Therefore, we are adjourned.